District Board of Education meeting on this Thursday, March 2nd, 2016. Welcome. I call this meeting to order. I'd please remind the board members to use their mic when speaking. ¿Hay alguien aquí que necesita intérprete para la junta esta noche? Thank you. We begin with the Pledge of Allegiance. I'd like to introduce the principal from Mount Madonna, Jennifer Bowen.
Hello, good evening. We had two students, unfortunately, one couldn't make it, but I would still like to brag about her and her absence. This is Edwin Castaneda. And so when I asked the staff at Mount Madonna to nominate and comment on exemplary students from our school, I received a long list of adjectives that actually both the students we selected share in common, which is why I invited them to come tonight proudly. Both Edwin and Christina were slated as non-grads at their home schools, but once they arrived at Mount Madonna, they refocused, made connections, and worked hard to become graduates. Both of them are enrolled already for Gavilan College in the fall and have applied for scholarships. These students have gone above and beyond our expectations at Mount Madonna. They've done a lot of extra credit, hold outstanding attendance, help out on campus regularly, in the classroom, have done community service projects for us, show respectful attitudes towards their peers and staff. Both students, hands down, stand out at our school because they're self-motivated collaborators. They demonstrate strong leadership skills and have developed focus and have determined what their goals are going forward. Specifically, one teacher wrote about Edwin. Edwin is a student who wants to truly understand the content and thinks critically, making connections not only in economics, but across all disciplines. Christina is a highly motivated student and grasps new and difficult concepts quickly. She always thinks one step ahead and has become an important and contributing member of the classroom and Mount Madonna community. Sorry she couldn't be here tonight. I'm proud to have both of these students here, or one of them here, to lead us in the flag salute, and it's been a pleasure having them and meeting them both at Mount Madonna. So this is Edwin.
Okay, please stand. Salute. Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And I just want to thank Mr. Hallmark, one of our teachers, for being here tonight, and Edwin's family are there in the back. So thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next up is approval of the agenda. I'll entertain a motion.
I'd like to pull one item, item 5I.
5I. Okay. I'll entertain a motion.
Move approval.
A second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Next up, recognition of Gilroy High School Choir.
Tonight, the district and Board of Education had the pleasure of honoring four very special students, along with their incredible teacher and mentor, Jonathan Souza, who've received a tremendous honor. These four students were selected for the 2016 High School Honors Performance Series at Carnegie Hall. And I know you're watching pictures of this as I speak. So these four singers performed during Carnegie Hall's 125th anniversary season on February 7th with the Honor Concert Choir. Now you probably ask, what is that? The Honors Performance Series was created to showcase accomplished individual high school performers on an international level by allowing them to study under master conductors and to perform at one of the most celebrated venues in the world, Carnegie Hall. Participation in one of the five honors ensembles is limited to the highest rated high school performers from across the world. This isn't just the United States. So, seniors Nicole Holder and Savannah Brandon, and juniors Skylar Hungerford and Alex Green, all students at Gilroy High School under the direction of Mr. Souza, had the once-in-a-lifetime privilege of performing at Carnegie Hall under the the renowned choral conductor and composer, Dr. Jeffrey Ames. Earlier this year, Nicole, Savannah, Skylar, and Alex auditioned for the Honors Performance Series and were accepted after review by the Honors Selection Board. Acceptance to this elite group is a direct result of the talent, dedication, and achievements demonstrated in their application and audition recording. Our four students were joined by performers from 49 states, Guam, six Canadian provinces, and a number of foreign countries, including China, Mexico, and South Korea, for a special performance at the world-famous Carnegie Hall, a venue that marks the pinnacle of musical achievement. According to Program Director Morgan Smith, and this is in quotes, being selected to the Honors Performance Series is something each finalist should be extremely proud of accomplishing. Sorry. We processed more than 18,000 nominations this year and have selected nearly 750 of the most talented student performers from around the world. Working with these conductors and performing at Carnegie Hall is an experience that these musicians will never forget. For Gilroy Unified to have four of those students selected out of 700, of only 750, remember, out of 18,000, is an amazing achievement and a testament to their hard work, talent, and desire to push to achieve to their greatest potential. It's also a testament to the brilliant teaching of our own Jonathan Souza, who has guided these students, recognized and encouraged their natural talents, and helped them on the path to great success. Thank you, Jonathan. On this once-in-a-lifetime trip, our four singers, who are all members of the GHS Chamber Singers, arrived in New York City on February 4th. Their time in the Big Apple was focused primarily on concert preparation, but the singers were also able to see a Broadway musical and visit several major attractions. The Honors Choir concert repertoire for the Carnegie performance included contemporary classical compositions by Dan Forrest, Jake Runstad, and Z. Randall Stroop. To close the program, the Honor Choir featured the American folk song, How Can I Keep From Singing?, and a gospel piece by conductor Dr. Ames titled, I Can Feel the Spirit. On behalf of the board and the entire school district, I'd like to express how proud we are of Nicole, Savannah, Skylar, and Alex, who represented Gilroy High School, the district, and the entire Gilroy community at the highest level during their performance at Carnegie Hall. So now that you've heard a little bit about how amazing these students are, by the way, they're all incredible students too and athletes, I'd like to invite them up to share a slideshow, which you've actually been seeing, followed by a short performance, and then they'll be joined by peers from the choir. I believe there are other students that are going to perform. So I'd like you to come up. And we're going to have you, first, let's recognize them. They're incredible. So before you sing, we just have a couple of things to show our appreciation for you and how excited we are about your performance. So we have a plant for each of you.
Sing for their plant.
Thank you. And you're welcome. Then we have a certificate for each of you.
Sing first.
Say a few words, and then we'll invite our choir up. While I'm getting set up here, we brought a gift back for our board, and as an appreciation, we have some programs from Carnegie Hall that we'd like to share with you. So Kids, if you could get that. Dr. Flores, President of the Board, Mr. Tovar, and members of the Gilroy Unified School Board of Education, thank you for having us here tonight to honor these outstanding, the outstanding achievement in the choral arts by Nicole, Savannah, Skylar, and Alex, who had an amazing time under Dr. Jeffrey Ames at Carnegie Hall in New York City. Words, it's hard to describe the experience for me as a director and seeing these four people challenge themselves in such a such a meaningful way. The four of them were nominated because of their musical ability, but also their drive to improve and challenge themselves and their intense commitment to their community, the Gilroy High School Chamber Singers. The recognition they receive is well deserved. So bravo to you. Though he is unable to be with us this evening, I would like to thank our principal at Gilroy High School, Dr. Marco Sanchez, for his tremendous support of the music department at GHS. His appreciation for the arts, academics, and athletics continue to make Gilroy High School a truly unique, comprehensive high school experience for our students and also our staff. Let's be honest, the arts have had a hard time, a struggle with educational support throughout our country in recent years. So with Doc's support of the diverse programs at Gilroy High School, both at the site and at the school site and district levels, we are sure to see more successes and opportunities for our student body at GHS. Some of our other successes in our department this year include 9 of our students participating in the CMEA Middle School Conference Choir, 3 participating in the ACDA Regional Honor Choir, 2 at the American Choral Directors Association State Honor Choir for the junior high school level, 3 participating in the State Honor Choir at the high school level, 4 students participating in our Choral Leadership Academy that our professional organization puts on each year, and our band playing at the opening ceremonies for Super Bowl City in San Francisco. And of course, these wonderful 4 students behind me at Carnegie Hall. And speaking with these students about being recognized for the performance at Carnegie Hall, they immediately wanted to consider their classmates and honor their contribution to success, which I think is pretty cool. Without the community of musicians we engage with daily, we can't fully realize our own potential and success, and myself included. I'm tremendously humbled by my students' commitment, their intelligence, and love for one another, and I have the privilege to encounter this on a daily basis. The ones who I'm most thankful to have in my professional life are my students, so thank you. In closing, Dr. Flores, members of the board, please always remember that music is not extra. It is an essential part of the human experience. I could go on and on about this and bore you to tears, I'm sure. But the importance, it is important for our music right now in our district. It's my hope that inclusion in musical arts education continues to be a priority for our district. And with the increased graduation requirements, I hope that the board and administration continue to support the arts program through whatever creative means is necessary to make access to our students a reality and not get pushed to the side because of A through G. A full and complete public high school education includes a visual and performing arts education, and I appreciate working in a district that does value that. Thank you very much for honoring my students. Thank you. We'd like to have our chamber singers come up and sing something that we're going to sing at San Jose State Choral Festival tomorrow. We'll be there. Also, Christopher High School and Claire Massey will be there performing and representing Gilroy. So this is just the first part of A Boy and a Girl by Erica Whitaker.
And the one thing I forgot to mention is Dr. Sanchez is not here tonight. He felt really bad about that. The reason is the wrestling team's competing right now in the state finals.
Oh. my job, Vivian.
Happy birthday to
you. You know the song, though, right? Come on.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Thank you all. Thank you.
And I should mention Chris Leung, who's our ASB director, and many other things at Gilroy High accompanied the students, along with some parents in the audience to the Carnegie Hall event. So thank you all for making it possible.
You sure you don't want to stay? Well, we're only going to be here till midnight.
Good luck. Thank you again, Court.
Thank you.
Say hi to Christina for me.
I will, for sure.
Mr. Souza, when's your next concert?
Oh, I missed my next concert. We have, actually, we're traveling to Los Angeles on our tour with the whole music department, all three choirs and the band, at the end of the month, March 31st through the 3rd. And then our spring concerts are April 19th and 20th. And the 19th will be at the Presbyterian Church in town, and the 20th will be at the Mission San Juan Bautista at 7:30.
Great.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you again. Next up, general public comments. At this time, members of the public may address the board on any item or any issue within the subject matter jurisdiction of the board that is not listed on this agenda. Members of the public may address the board on an agenda item before or during board's consideration of the item. No action can be taken on an item not on the agenda at this time, but may be referred to the administration to put on a future agenda. In accordance with board bylaw 9323, individuals' remarks will be limited to 3 minutes each unless otherwise stipulated. And my wonderful board vice president, Ms. Midgard, will be in charge of reading all names and also as official timekeeper. If you're not, if you go past 3 minutes.
So we're doing consent first.
You want to consent first?
The two consent.
Is it on a consent item? This is
a consent
public
item.
Comment,
this is
not
just the regular.
On the agenda.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll do, yeah.
Thank you. Okay. So here we go. These are on items that are not on the agenda, but somebody wants to talk about it with us. And the first speaker is Julie Collins.
Can I just walk up there?
Yes, please.
Well, I want to say happy birthday. My birthday is tomorrow too. So
it actually
I didn't know
was
we shared.
Tuesday, but every day this week. This has been happening.
That's
which
so
I'm
fun.
Not complaining about.
Well, happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday.
Yeah.
Okay, let me lower this a little bit. Okay. Good evening, distinguished board members and superintendent, administrators, and the community. Thank you for the opportunity to speak on a topic that is the utmost important in the future for our students in Gilroy, overall the entire Gilroy. In recent months, our parent club had decided to terminate the library clerk position at Luigi Aprea Elementary School. The parent club voted to no longer financially support this position with parent and donated funds. Keep losing my space. The termination was quickly rescinded when the Luigi community was made aware of the termination by a letter from Dr. Flores to every student or the families. Parent club reluctantly agreed and paid part of the salary for one more year. Since then, the Luigi community has been working towards strategies to fund this position with district dollars going forward. In our research, we have learned that most of the libraries in Gilroy Unified are not staffed with a library clerk. Apparently, many years ago when funding from the state was sparse or non-existent, it was voted on by previous board to no longer fund library clerk positions. A library clerk position is considered now an extra for the school, not an integral part of the school's culture or climate. I, as a Luigi parent and community member and a registered voter, would like to change that. I think there is no better time than now that we make what has wronged been right. With the development and planning of our LCAP funding, we can tie staff libraries into our plan, not just for Luigi, but for all Gilroy schools. In the district's LCAP goals, we see many areas where the library clerk positions could be included. The first one is to provide equitable support for all learners. To provide equitable student access, students must have not only access to library, but have highly qualified staff members there to assist them. In this advanced digital age, where we are racing to teach our students 21st century skills, all students need to learn the value of library and how to conduct proper research. Students left to their own devices will gravitate towards the same books or styles. A library clerk can guide them to topics and authors that they've never imagined, which I have seen firsthand by the teachers at Luigi and the library clerk with my own son. Also, a qualified library clerk can teach research methods through text and digital. Students on their own might write a research paper based on opinion because they just go to Google. But with a library clerk, they can learn how to actually research a real paper. Many students do not otherwise have access to a library, including the Gilroy Public Library. The school library is their only opportunity to access this.
Ms. Collins, about 30 seconds.
Okay. The last thing we wanted to say is that goal five is to ensure equitable and well-maintained facilities. Well, Gilroy Unified has many beautiful libraries that are less than 10 years old. And so we want to change that and let all our libraries be staffed with a library clerk, at least part-time. One of the things I really wanted to say is in the last year and a half, I've suffered with Lyme disease. If it was not for the teachers and for the library clerk at our school, for my son, an accelerated reader, he would nowhere be where he's at today. So this is just near and dear to my heart.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The next speaker is Jennifer Foster.
Good evening. I am also speaking about our school library subject. I have here in my hand over 175 Luigi Aprea supporters who have signed a petition to save our library. I'd like to share a few of the comments noted on our petition, and this is just a very few. One is, so important, kids need books. Another is, we need our library. Library is an integral part of our school. The library touches all students. And I cannot imagine a school without books to read for learning and recreation. You will make much extra work for teachers and deprive students without it. And lastly, our library is the only opportunity for some kids to have regular access to books. These are just a few of the very many comments that parents, students, teachers, and community members have shared on our petition. The school district and its board have repeatedly shown their support for school libraries. It's evidenced in the brand new library that was just built at Christopher High School. It's also evidenced in the proposed new library for Brownell Middle School that was in the draft master plan presented at the last board meeting and is up for approval later tonight. Every school district library has been approved and voted by the district and the board. So I ask you, Superintendent Flores, President Tovar, and board members, why support a library and not support the infrastructure for it to operate? I'd also like to take this opportunity to please ask for this to be on the agenda at a future board meeting, so that we can further present our case and hopefully start to make some change here in Gilroy. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. The next speaker is Linda Wanslow.
Good evening, everyone. I'm a kindergarten teacher at Luigi Aprea School, and I'm here with a teacher's perspective on the importance of school libraries being available to students, for school libraries being run in a competent and professional manner, and an opinion on how those libraries should be funded. I assume that all of you are aware that our district has many students, including students at Luigi Aprea School, who have little or no access to library books outside of school. Students who have never been to the Gilroy Public Library. Students who have few, if any, books they actually own or have available at their homes. For many students, the only library books that they currently read originate from their school library. Our library at Luigi Aprea is presently available to our students in many capacities for their various needs. Whether it be science research projects, state projects, mission projects, animal reports, biography reports, reading to accommodate state standards and Common Core mandates, and possibly most importantly, our school library provides students with books for reading practice, the Accelerated Reader Program, and of course, books just for reading pleasure. It is understandable that in these changing times, computers and tablets are changing the way things are managed for reading, writing, and research. The internet does not, however, replace what is available at a well-managed and staffed library. Most importantly, the library experience does not involve all of the indiscretions of the internet. It is evident that school libraries have an undisputed need for a librarian or library clerk. Teachers are already overburdened with responsibilities and should not be expected to take on one more duty to become librarians for their classes. Can you imagine keeping things straight, 30-something teachers trying to manage the necessary requirements of successfully running a library for 700-plus students? That does not paint a pretty picture in my mind. As for funding library clerk positions, it should not be expected that parents and parent clubs take on that financial responsibility. Funding library clerks should be a funding priority of the district in cases where site funds are not available.
About 30 seconds, please.
It is my understanding that Luigi Aprea School is the only school in the district that does not receive Title I funds. It is also my understanding that at other schools, the use of Title I funds, while possibly not directly used for funding library clerk positions, are at least used to finance other endeavors, leaving money available from other sources for funding libraries. So in conclusion, and in the interest of fairness, it would be extremely prudent of the district if you could make funding library clerk positions a priority for schools such as ours who are in need of financial assistance. It would be very much appreciated if you would add this concern to an agenda item for your next meeting. Thank you. And if I could add a personal note, my kindergarten class and I would like to thank you and the district for the book you donated to our class in honor of Dr. Seuss and Read Across America. The kids really enjoy it. It's on our little library shelf in my classroom. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Next item, reports taken in closed session. We have a few here. So during closed session, the Board of Trustees took the following actions. A, removal, suspension, expulsion of a student. The board reviewed case number 2016-08. Do I have a motion?
So move.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Point of clarification. Please. What is the motion for? Is it for expulsion?
Move to expel.
Move to expel. Sorry about that. Yeah. Any other motions? Okay. Next item, item B, public employee discipline.
Wait, no, there's another one.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Wasn't that the suspended expulsion?
Move suspend the expulsion.
Okay. Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Nope. Okay. Got one. Okay. Thank you. Next item, public employee discipline, dismissal, release.
Excuse me.
Yes.
There was a stipulated agreement that the board needs to take.
Okay.
Take a motion on.
Take action.
Yeah. Did anybody bring the case number? I'm sorry, I put my closed session materials away.
Yeah, I have it here.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we need a motion for that also.
Okay. We need a motion for case number 2016-06.
I would make a motion to accept the stipulation.
Okay.
Second.
Do I have all those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Thank you. Thank you. I was going to wait till the end, but thank you for that. Okay.
We also have a readmit?
A couple announcements. So next, public employee discipline dismissal. The board voted unanimously to non-reelect one probationary teacher. That's case number 15/16-52. Next, notice of release of temporary teacher 15/16-53. The board voted unanimously to release 15 temporary teachers. The board also voted to send a release notice to one certificated administrator. In addition, the board voted unanimously to reject claim number 4330. And next, remission of a student to school maintained by the district. There's no reportable action. Next, reports to the board. First up, student board member Virginia Diaz Lazaro from DECA.
Good evening, Board of Trustees and members of the community. I'm Virginia Diaz Lazaro from Dr. TJ Owens Gilroy Early College Academy, also known as GECA, and tonight I will present on GECA and South Valley Middle School. So I just want to start off by recapping February at GECA. We held our annual bridge competition. We handed out Valentine grams. We had presentations from the nonprofit Community Solutions. We had a Sadie Hawkins dance, and one of our students was recognized by Gavilan. And then March, this month, we have GECA March Gladness. We have Pennies for Patience. And then we have guest speakers Jimmy Panetta and Casey Lucius presenting at school. And then we have our talent show. So the bridge competition was held in February, and basically students were given a model kit and they were told to build a bridge and just journal everything. And it was a competition, and the first place winner was Brandon Kruger, a freshman, and his bridge held up to 67 pounds and he was awarded $400. The second place winner was Miranda Sandoval, also a freshman, and her bridge held 37 pounds and she was awarded $200. And then our third place winners were a pair of seniors, and it was Mateo Rodriguez and Kendall White, and their bridge held 30 pounds and they were each awarded $50. And here I have a couple of pictures, and you can see a bridge and then a design journal and a couple of students with a broken bridge. Unfortunately, theirs did not hold much, but they were good sports. And here we have students, and they are intently watching and putting weight on their bridge. And as you can see, there's a huge group of students just watching, very careful, holding their breaths. So we had many fundraisers. We had the Valentine Grams, which was run by the freshman class. We also had a fundraiser at Chevy's on the 24th, which was very successful. And we just had a fundraiser night at Famous Dave's last night. So we had a presentation by Community Solutions, a nonprofit organization, and they presented on stress, depression, and anxiety, and just how to handle it, because lately the school climate staff noticed that it was down and students were very stressed. So they wanted to give students just an outlet and a place to call in case they weren't comfortable with staff or others. And to lighten the mood, we had a dance at the end of the month, and it was a Sadie Hawkins dance. It was 50s themed sock hop. It was very well attended. And as you can see, there's a couple pictures right there, and we have some students having a really good time. So it was just a nice time to de-stress and relax. So our junior, Brian Bruce, was awarded artistic excellence by the department head of the art department at Gavilan College. And we are all very happy for him. And here we have a couple pieces of his artwork. We have still life and figure drawings. He was very excited, and it was a big honor for him. And like I said, we have GECA March Gladness instead of Madness to promote positivity and just to promote the character count pillars and good deeds. And it's just a kind of like a reward system on bingo cards, I guess you could think of them. And they get stickers on their bingo cards for any good deeds that staff see them doing. So it's just to keep up a good spirit, especially in this time where we're all kind of having college midterms plus like high school tests and a lot's going on. So it's just to keep everything positive and just character counts. So we are also running a Pennies for Patient drive, and the money earned is going towards Leukemia and Lymphoma Society, and GECA is very excited to help. We're running it over a 3-week period, and we're running it like Penny Wars to get all the students excited. So Penny Wars are pennies count as, think about, I don't want to say war, that's a little bit negative, but kind of like that. It's a competition between classes, and basically pennies are positive points, and anything else is not. It's negative, so it's taken away. And all of this is going towards spirit points. And at the end of the year, those spirit points will be calculated, and the winning class with the most spirit points will get a prize. We also have Congressional District 20 candidates coming to speak, and they're coming to speak because of the GECA Politics Club. We have Casey Lucius and Jimmy Panetta, and we are very excited to host them at school. We also have the talent show coming up at the end of this month, and it's on March 25th. Doors open at 5, and it's from 5:30 to 8 at the Gavilan Theater. Tickets are $5, so you should definitely come and support our school. And we have around 14 acts, all grade levels, and very diverse. So now South Valley Middle School. And they have also been very busy. In January, 8th grade students attended the Biomed program at GHS. They also shadowed the dual immersion program. They registered for high school. And South Valley held parent night and combined it with the science fair display. And then elementary students, 5th graders from Los Animas and Rod Kelly came and shadowed at South Valley. So here you can see students. They're very excited at the Biomed program at Gilroy High School. That was very exciting. Only 50 students attended. It was very selective, and it was just an exciting time to kind of see what's to come ahead in their high school career. Another batch of students also attended, shadowed the GHS dual immersion program to see the facility and what it has to offer. And 8th graders registered for high school, which was a big step moving on in their educational career. And they learned how to read transcripts and calculate their GPA, which was very interesting, what from I heard from the counselors, and it was quite a process, but very exciting for all of the 8th graders who get to move on. And Parent Night and Science Fair was combined, and it was very well attended by many parents, and as you can see, there were many, many boards by the middle schoolers, but it was incredible. I know you can't really see them, but there was a lot. And 5th graders from Los Animas and Rod Kelly shadowed the South Valley students, and here you can see some of the 5th graders. We're having a blast. I wish I could fit all the pictures. It was incredible. It was awesome. You can see just a ton of students. And South Valley has a school play coming up, Hawaii Calls, and it's Friday and Saturday, so you should also go and support. It's at 6 p.m. And that's it. I mean, we've been very busy, both South Valley and GECA, and we have a lot coming up, so thank you.
Wow, thank you.
Great report.
Oh, Dr. Flores, can you top that?
I can't. I think we should change the order. Yeah. These students are amazing and when they give their reports. Well, I don't have a PowerPoint, so. Anyway, I'd like to start by calling out our CalSOAP counselors and our academic coordinators at the high school level. As you know, I have a senior this year, so I've been experiencing firsthand what a great job our ACs and our CalSOAP folks do getting kids ready for the college application process. So they've made themselves available on a regular basis, weekly. They have hours in the library for students, and most recently, I participated in a parent workshop at night where they helped parents and students complete what's called the FAFSA, which is a financial aid application. But I just want to say I'm really impressed with the job they're doing, and I know this is happening at both of our comprehensive high schools. I visited a number of sites in the last 2 weeks. We had a APS visit at one of our sites at Robley. And then I've started my spring site visits, and board members have been visiting with me. So we've done Mount Madonna, Elliott, Christopher High, and Gilroy High today. And I want to add to what was said earlier. Actually, 175 eighth graders visited the Bioscience Academy. And by the way, we only have 75 spots. That's the 75. So we're for the first time faced with what are we going to do about that? So we have and the board's going to be hearing a report on the Bioscience Academy in the next couple months, just to give you an update on what's happening at the Academy. And we also had the most eighth graders visit the dual immersion program. I think it was around 70. So we really have a lot of interest in these two special programs at Gilroy High. But what I want to say about all of the visits, especially the APS visits now that we've concluded them, is we've seen significant growth from last year to this year. Are we not done? One more. They're giving me the finger. One more to go. Sorry. So we've completed 14 APS site visits and have one more to go. But in general, I think our team would like to share with you that we've seen tremendous growth from a year ago to these APS visits this time. Really high level of implementation of district initiatives and very high student engagement at a lot of our sites. So we're really pleased with what we've seen. Of course, I have a lot of monthly meetings. So at SPAC this month, the Superintendent Parent Advisory Committee, we had a safety presentation. Cheryl Galloway was here. And an officer came, and we talked about Run, Hide, Defend and all the steps we're taking to ensure that our students are safe. I had my monthly meeting with Vince Olbers, the GTA president, and Stephanie. And we had a meeting for the first time with our new mayor and the city administrator, interim city administrator, on Tuesday. And some very interesting things came out of that meeting, which I'll be sharing with you in my weekly report. And today we had the South County Youth Task Force policy team meeting. I was late, so I missed the beginning, but Linda was there. Last Friday, I want to talk about the Green Barn at Gilroy Gardens. We were invited to sort of initiate the new Green Barn, and I want all parents in our community to know about the Green Barn. It's a building that it's actually an old barn that they've renovated and painted green, and I think it cost about $400,000. And now is this beautiful classroom with lots of lights, with stations, and we had a class from Rod Kelly go over and be the first class to get to participate in a lesson there. The lessons are they're designed for individual classes, not for the masses. So students rotate through the Green Barn, and we saw a lesson on rocks, and it was just incredible. I'm so excited about this, and now we just need to figure out how to have more of our classes go, because it's expensive since it's just one class at a time. So Barb Granter and I were brainstorming about grants that we could write so we could have more of our students go and participate. It's really cool and aligned with the Common Core standards. Yesterday, we had Read Across America. And I thought it was one of the best events we've had in our district in a long time. It just went so well all over the district. We all read. Every site had 20, 30, 40 people come throughout the community, come and read. And what was great is, and I give Morgan Hill credit for this, they have, over the years that they've been doing it, selected Common Core aligned books that are aligned with the standards taught at that grade level. So all of us were reading books that are aligned with what the students are learning at that grade level. And they were incredible books. I read at third grade and fifth grade at two schools, and just amazing books. So I thought that, and there was tremendous participation all over the district, and obviously we want to do it again next year. And then yesterday afternoon, we had our final dedication of the Christopher High Sports Complex, because it's finally done. So everything is done. The entire project is done, and we had an event, a ribbon cutting event at the new entrance, which has beautiful columns, and I thought it was very well attended. I'd like to call out some special events that are coming up. So now I get to get back at Fred. every meeting been talking about my award as Superintendent of the Year. So now I get to call out Fred's being recognized this Saturday night by CADAS. And he will be receiving the Community Champion Award. Congratulations, Fred. And I know a number of us will be there. And that's for an elected official.
Right.
And the other recognition on Saturday night that's very much near and dear to us is the Youth and Philanthropy Latino Family Fund will be recognized for their work at South Valley and at Solar Sauna, which is a wonderful program. And we're very excited about them also being recognized. Next Tuesday, I'm going to attend a CTA luncheon with our GTA president, and I'm looking forward to that. And next Saturday, we have at Gilroy High our annual parent university. I hope a number of people will be attending that next Saturday morning. And on the 24th and 25th, Rock the Mock, and I think just about all board members have signed up to be interviewers. And it's a great day. We do one day at Christopher and one at Gilroy, and we have board members, community members, business owners come and put students through mock interviews. And it's really powerful. They also rotate between four stations. And so there's the interview station, the dress for success station, how to get ready for the interview, and a handshake workshop. And also some very inspirational speakers this year. I hope the board members will get a chance to stay for that. And then, as we announced last time, Los Animas was selected out of the state as a recipient of the Seal of Excellence Award by CABE. And they will be receiving that award on March 25th, which is the Gilroy High Mock the Rock. But I plan to go straight from there to San Francisco, as I'm sure some of you will, to be there. It's very prestigious that Los Animas was selected out of the entire state. They were one of eight finalists last time I told you, and they have been selected to receive the award. On Monday, they have a gold ribbon award site validation visit, and I'll be going over there for that. So it's pretty exciting that Los Animas is receiving these distinctions. And that concludes my report. Oh, I did want to mention a couple of things. I'm going to embarrass board members about their children. So I want to, you heard the choir singing before, and Sloane Pace is in that choir. She was standing over on the left.
She's a sharp one.
And she is also the female star in the play that is happening tomorrow night and Saturday night. And what's the name of that play?
It's Once on This Island, and it is Friday at 7 and Saturday at 2.
Okay, so see if you can get to one of those shows. And then I want to embarrass Mr. Good, because maybe you didn't see it, but we all saw a very long article about his son, Stephen Good, who's going to be one of the two nurses, I guess, and Nightmare Nurse, or you want to talk about that?
No, he's the male lead. He's not the nurse.
He's not the nurse. And Why do they have that caption?
Nightmare Nurse is the name of the movie.
Yes.
But he got his start here at Gilroy Unified. He was in the choir for 4 years, the chamber choir for 3 years, and he got his first acting break as a senior in Annie Get Your Gun right at Gilroy High School.
Isn't that great? What a great story. So, and look what can happen. So the name of the movie is Nightmare Nurse?
Correct.
And when will it be coming out?
It'll be on the Lifetime Channel this Saturday
at
5 and 9.
Well, congratulations to both of you.
Set your DVRs.
We're all going to Mr. Good's house to watch it, so you're all invited.
Okay.
Well, one thing, Debbie, you didn't share, obviously, is your son's also applying to colleges, right?
Yes.
Any updates?
Yeah, we've heard from a couple, so we feel relieved. It's a very rigorous process, and I'm actually, as I always have been as superintendent, as I've moved through the years with my son, I learn about what's happening in our district, and it's been invaluable, but especially this year, going through the college application process and seeing what parents and students have been enduring for years, it's come to life for me. And I can't say enough about the support that we've been given at Gilroy High, and I know Christopher does the same thing. But our district's doing a great job of helping students who are going through this very challenging process, which is hopefully almost over in the next month. It'll be at least as far as which college he's going to.
And I feel free, because as you know, my daughter's has applied to 10 schools, and I know Trustee Good's going to love this. So she applied to 10, and has gotten to 3 of the 4 that already have called her.
Yeah.
We're waiting on Santa Clara, so she doesn't want to go to Stanford. She wants to go to Santa Clara.
It's worth the wait.
The CSUs are notifying right now this week, so by the end of the week, and then the UCs start notifying around the middle of March, and the privates are later.
Later, yeah.
So
good. Well, thank you, Debbie.
Thanks.
You. Next item, consent agenda. Before we move for approval, we do have a few speakers.
Okay, the first speaker who wishes to address 5C is Jennifer Foster. And that item is establish a management position, special education coordinator.
Good evening again. I saw this on the agenda and I just thought that I would mention that from what little of it that I can read about it on the agenda, I do think that this is probably a fantastic position for our district to have. My hope for it would be that it offers some better oversight for services for our special ed students, especially in particular OT. My daughter gets OT services. And just wanted to share that over the past 2 years, the OT services have been very inconsistent. We've gone through long periods of time without any OT, and then trying to make it up, do the regular OT plus compensatory OT. There seems to be very high turnover for that position. It's a very high demand position. I have that most respect for those people that can come in there and do that for our children. I would hope that the addition of the special education coordinator would offer some more consistent and hopefully get us more compliant with our OT services. Thank you.
Thank you.
We can respond to this because it's on the agenda.
That's true.
Right? Yes. Yeah, I just like to, you've identified exactly the purpose of this position.
Exactly.
We need to pay more attention to our special ed. There have been some omissions. We want to fill the gaps that we currently have. Mm-hmm. So that's exactly what our plan is.
Yep.
Glad to hear it.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Good.
Okay, the next speaker is Judy Ann Rosti. And she is speaking on the same item, 5C.
Good evening, everybody. Basically, echoing what Jennifer just said, my son is in special ed as well. He is supposed to be getting some OT. That's one that concerns us a lot because there seems to be high turnover. At the end of the year last year, the last week before school, we're rushing in to get him some compensatory services. And this year so far, he's supposed to have one-on-one OT. He's not had any. I think it's supposed to start last week when we had someone employed from October last year, and he still hasn't had anything. And the results now are like, oh, we're gonna do it after school on a Wednesday. And I don't know, any of you have a child in special ed, to have them in school 5.5 hours every day. After school, he has to go to OT and then homework. It's a lot. It's a lot for him. So I'm really looking forward to having this person oversight for the district and accountability for the people who are employed, because I know a lot of them are contractors from just companies. And I think it's such a beneficial role. We really do need it. So thanks for considering it.
Thank you. Thank you both for those comments. So now I'll entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Move approval. Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Passes. Thank you. Next item, item 6, public hearing, notice of proposed increase in statutory mitigation fees on residential and commercial industrial development. I'll open this up for a public hearing.
Thank you, President Tobar, members of the board, and members of the public. Good evening. This is a public hearing. As you know, the State Allocation Board sets the residential and commercial rates, which they've done on February 24th. The rating was an increase of 3.5% over the prior years, which they're typically set every two-year cycle. So the current rate would be $3.48 per square foot on residential construction and 56 cents for commercial. There is an exemption of addition of 500 square feet or less that did not change. This is a public hearing, so it's open for the public.
Any discussion, any questions? Okay. I'll now close this hearing. Next item, item 6B, we have a resolution, number 15-16-50, approval of imposing statutory mitigation fees on residential and commercial industrial development projects. And this is a resolution.
Thank you, President Tobar. So the increase of 3.59% would yield approximately $136,000 based on the annual expectation of $3.8 million on developer fees. Of course, the fees will change depending on the development activity, but that's just to give you an idea of what revenue we're talking about for on an annual basis. The resolution will be filed and a copy will be hand-delivered to the city. It will take 60 days from today's action for them to increase the fees, so it'll be in effect of May 2nd.
Any questions? No.
Move for approval.
Do I have a second? Roll call vote.
Heather Bass?
Yes.
Mark Good?
Yes.
Pat Midgard?
Yes.
James Pace?
Yes.
Linda Pacino?
Yes.
Jaime Rosso?
Yes.
Fred Tovar?
Yes. Good. Passes. Thank you. Next item, item 7A, approval of facilities master plan and needs assessment. Mr. Missa?
Thank you once again. So we're pleased to provide the board with a final master plan, facilities master plan and needs assessment. It's been a really long road to get here. And I wanna thank those board members especially that participated in this long process, as well as the entire board, of course, and our superintendent for your feedback. We did bring this as a draft on February 11th, and today we have a final product to review real briefly with you. You have a hard copy of it. I see you most of you looking at it, and it's in your binder. So this document will be posted on our website. Of course, we'll maintain it. It will be a livable document that we'll update as we engage and complete projects. We'll maintain it. It's a tool as well as a visionary planning tool. It's a roadmap for the next decade, if not 15 years or more, for us. We've invested a lot of time into this process, and we're very pleased with the end result. So I know Jim Bambachi wants to say a few words before we turn it over to Don from LPA.
Yes, thank you. I just like to say that from the beginning, when we interviewed the architectural groups, it was a very grinding process. And all the effort that was put into this is been well worth it. We've got what I consider to be an excellent document. And I really look forward to getting this document approved and then moving forward and actually working from this document in the future, so.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can't see the PowerPoint, so I'll just speak to you and, there it is. Okay. Thank you, Mighty Bell. Whenever we're invited to come into one of these processes, it's always very apparent to me and really kind of moving in a way that we're being invited into a district's home and to be involved in something that is really very close to all of you. And so I appreciate the invitation to come and address you and kind of bring this to a close. I'm also always aware that the planning that we're doing as part of this process, this isn't where planning in this district started, and this isn't where the kind of improvement of this district started. You've been doing this for a long time. It's very clear to me that this is what we're doing here and what you're going to do with this plan. It's just part of a continuity that has gone on for a long time and will continue to go on. And as Alvaro said, this is a long-term document. And I think what this was about was really We didn't come in and say this is how it should be done. This was really designed by the district to be a very collaborative process, a transparent process. It was really great to see how many people got involved in it. And so these are really your ideas that came out of that. So that's really the overview of this process. I think really what I wanted to say here is I don't want to go through the entire schedule, but I think it's important to say that as part of the process, what you asked us to do was get information from a lot of different sources. And so those sources included going out to your sites and us looking at the sites individually. It included meeting with principals, with teachers, with committees, with yourselves, and getting a lot of different perspectives on what your long-term needs were. So lots of different meetings. It was really impressive to see how, as you said, Jim, the hard work that went on, lots of very long, grueling meetings where everybody participated and really thinking very hard about what the needs are. When I think about coming to a meeting like this tonight, you hear the challenges that the district has to deal with, and I think that is reflected in the overall master plan, the hard choices that districts have to make, but also the opportunities when you see the good work that the district is doing. Frankly, this very moving presentation, the singers that came in and kind of transported me to another place, and then Ms. Diaz-Lazaro, the excellent presentation you did tonight. We see a lot of good presentations, and you really handled that one very well. One aspect of the master plan is developing the long-term vision for the school district. And everybody came together and shared their ideas and really worked hard to come up with what I think is a long-term educational vision. So a lot of discussion about how technology is going to affect the district and what kind of spaces really are going to improve the ability of students to learn in a 21st century kind of environment. That was done, I think, as part of this. And the list of projects that came out of it, there was a very specific list of projects. Something that happens when you're doing these master plans is there's always so many needs that are identified. And I think the district did a really great job of saying, what are the strongest needs that we need to identify to address over the next 15 or 20 years, and really cast a broad net and identify, really not be limited just by an idea of what the available funds are, but really go beyond that. I think the district did it, but then also brought a level of reality and practicality to it and said, we really want to have a plan at the end of the day that really is an implementable plan. And I think that was a strong part of the vision that came out of it. Everything that was done was guided by a set of principles that were developed by the committees at the very beginning of the process. And I'm not going to read all these, but you know, they had to do with providing state-of-the-art learning environments that were designed to improve student outcomes. And it was about, they talked about providing safe and secure environments, but at the same time, making sure that the spaces were welcoming and student-centered. There was discussion about technological change and adopting the latest technology, but at the same time, doing it in a way that's going to allow for change over time in a very practical kind of way. Improving and maintaining the district's good, strong brand image through the appearance of facilities. So there are people who don't ever even step foot on your campus, but make sure that they can see the good work that's being done through the brand that's created by the quality of the facilities. Equal access to educational programs for all students was a very important principle. And then providing facilities that allow teachers and maintenance people and all the people in the district to be able to have the kind of training that they need to maintain facilities and operate the schools. So a prioritization system process was taking place. And that's, you know, that's where the challenge comes in, right? Lots of good ideas, and how do you know what we're going to do first? So the district went through, without thinking about how many dollars are available or what the value of the projects are, and really said, if we were going to be doing these projects, how would we line them up so that as we go through them, we're always advancing the district toward its long-term goals? Whether we make it all the way through or whether we make it part of the way through, we're advancing ourselves, so we're always making progress toward those big goals. And I think it's important to show that you started by thinking about all of the good work that the district has done so far, that dollars have been spent to already advance the district in the sites that are listed here. And so then to continue looking at other sites and what the strongest needs were. Then to put it all into perspective, there was one final exercise where we came in with this. The idea was this shape was kind of a thermometer. And each one of the colored bars that you see there represented in scale a dollar value and a bundle of scope, if you will, on specific projects that came up. For example, a new elementary school or modernization work at the middle schools. And as the committee went through and put these up, you could see that hard choices have to be made in terms of what can be done within the dollars. But at any rate, so this exercise was addressed that idea that there was a limited amount of funds, but you didn't know what amount of funds were going to be available at that time. So from that, a specific implementation plan was put together. Now, I think it's important to say here that this implementation plan is hypothetical. It's based on the values that were of priority that was put together in the last chart. And the district has a lot of flexibility to be able to approach this in many different ways. But this was one way to address the needs that were identified in the district. And what this shows is over time, with a specific amount of bond funds that are going to be available, not all at once, but are going to be available over time, that how you could go through and take those priority projects and deliver them to the district over a series of years. And thinking about the long-term nature of this, this goes out all the way out to 2026. And I'd kind of finish this by saying that as we did this, we looked at, we know that if you start a project next year, it's going to have a different impact in terms of inflation than a project you start in 2020. So as we did this, we applied some inflation numbers to that and really showed a scenario where the district can make some really substantial contribution toward meeting its goals over the next 15 or 20 years. So with that, if there are any questions, I'd be happy to try to answer them.
Any questions from the board? Trustee Mickard?
Well, I'd like to make a comment that it was really a pleasure to work with your firm, and I was lucky to be one of the board members. There were three of us that served on this committee, and I guess we did have a lot of meetings looking back, but I mean, that's the name of the game. We do have a lot of meetings, but I think we accomplished a lot at the end, and I think your staff had the challenge of getting us to think. If you get tied down just to the money, then you can't think creatively. It limits you. So we had to do this exercise. We were thinking futuristically about what would we want a school to look like, because education is changing so much. I mean, I was in a classroom today with Dr. Flores over at Gilroy High, and it's our biomed class, and nobody was seated. Everybody was on their feet and working throughout the lab, and it's so different from, let's say, schools 30 years ago. So that's so exciting. And so we're looking way down the line. And I think it's an honor to be on a committee that I might never see the fruition. I might never see the end results of this. Many of us won't. But it's great that we can be part of the planning process. So thanks to your firm, please thank your assistants because they were great to work with.
I will go back and talk to Jomay and,
yeah,
and everyone else. There were really a lot of people that were working behind the scenes that you guys never had the opportunity to meet working on this. So
somebody did all this.
It was a lot of work.
This isn't what it looked like when we were working on
and
this.
Anyway, but it was also very rewarding for us to be part of it with you. So thanks for saying that.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions, comments? Nope. Well, this is an action item. I'll entertain a motion.
Move approval.
Second.
I have a second. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Passes. And again, thank you again for all your hard work and for all those that participated on this committee. I know we have three board members, Pat, James, and Jaime, who also represented the board. So thank you all for all your hard work.
We had a lot of staff and public. And
yes.
It was a very open process.
Thank you. Next item, item 7B. Ordering a school bond election and authorizing necessary actions in connection therewith. And this will be a resolution item.
Thank you, Trustee Tobar. I will provide a little bit of background just to make sure that the resolution for the members of the public is understood. This resolution is crafted now that we have a master plan precisely to follow in the next steps. So think about the planning stages. So, yes, the master plan has a visionary component to it, but we also have to be practical and look at the priorities, the funding sources, and how can we accomplish those goals. Right now, the state budget is pretty much saying, local boards, you come up with a local solution, is essentially what the governor is saying. There is no plan that he's supporting, even though it already qualified to be on the November initiative. He's basically opposing that initiative that would yield additional dollars for facilities, for schools, that would then match our dollars. So we really have to do this on our own. I do have to thank the voters that passed Measure P back in 2008. As you saw that chart that Don just showed you, we've had a number of wonderful improvements here in Gilroy that really transformed most of our schools, but there's still a lot of work to be done. We still need a new elementary school, aging middle schools, technology infrastructure throughout. There's some roofs, even this very roof that needs work. So we have a ton of need. And what the governor is essentially saying is now you have a local problem, you deal with it locally. So this is why that resolution is crafted with John Isom's help and Oric, who's our bond counsel, really delicately and accounted for the voter survey that was conducted a while ago that basically said, well, what would voters support? And we found out that we have good, strong support from the voters in Gilroy, thankfully, because we've been good stewardships of their funds, of taxpayers' money. And luckily, I asked Jim to stay here with me because he's a large part of that. He's a large part of what we do in the bond program, and we're lucky to have him. So the resolution tonight is geared towards June election, but we have not made that determination. It's geared towards June because there's a deadline of March 11th for the board to take action should it go in June. So that's obviously one of the key things that we need to decide tonight is if you approve a resolution to go out for a bond, do you want that to be in June? And if so, then this resolution needs to be approved tonight, or you have a discussion about when, and if that when is determined to be November, then we have time. And I would recommend that if November is what you would like to do, then I would bring back a similar resolution to you in June. So that would be the sequence of things. But obviously the key thing is to hear from you and your thoughts, and we'll take your direction.
And is John going to weigh in on the June versus November, as you have with some of us individually?
Yes. Please.
At the CSBA conference, we did this one-on-one. So.
Good evening, members of the board and community and district staff. Happy birthday, Dr. Flores.
Thank you.
This is an important decision, obviously. It goes without saying that this is a very important decision for the district, one that usually comes around once a decade. And as was mentioned, these are projects that are going to extend for the next, 30 to 40 to 50 years, really, when you talk about some of the types of improvements that you're looking at. The culmination of all of this effort, and that effort being defined by the meetings, the master plan, the survey, the public reach, the outreach to the community, the culmination is this resolution. And what this resolution essentially does is summarize what we believe to be a program that would be accepted among your voters. I think if you remember back to earlier board meetings, I would talk about the importance of crafting a program that the voters would support, because it's their schools, it's their tax dollars, it should be their bond program. So rather than say, we're doing this, voters, now campaign committee, go tell everybody what a great idea we have, the idea is to figure out what in advance the voters are willing to support. So this resolution covers the projects that we believe that the voters would support and that are reflected in the master plan. It is a conservative bond program as far as utilizing the district's tax base and generating proceeds upwards of $170 million. And I say conservative because bond programs are based on your assessed value and then future projections of what assessed value will be in the future. So historically, this district has grown well over 4.5% as far as assessed value year over year. Some years you have double-digit growth. Some years you've had negative growth, particularly in the years of the recession. But if you go back the last 10, 15, 20 years, you're well over 4% growth. This program's 3.5%. It's good to be conservative. The downside of being conservative just means you get the money sooner. If you're wrong and you're too aggressive, then the tax rate goes above what we told voters it would be. So that's something that we wanted to avoid. The question of June versus November, you know, which is maybe the only reason I'm up here right now, but I wanted to give you that little preamble. It is a good question, and there's pros and cons to both. First off, the district's own history. So the district, its most two recent bonds, all the way back in 2008, which was a presidential election, and then 2002, which was actually a gubernatorial. So the district has some history of being successful in both. The survey itself statistically was indifferent or showed no bias towards one or the other. And what that means is that when we did that survey of the 400 registered voters, we're able to isolate likely June voters who we characterize as high propensity voters. They never miss an election. Mm-hmm. They show up even at the low turnout elections. How do they feel about it? And it was 61% approval. And then we isolated the November voters, which would be, what about this group that only shows up for president? Mm-hmm. You know, they tend to be low propensity voters. They don't vote except every 4 years. And that was 62%. We have a lot of districts where we work, and those numbers are 80% with the November and 60% with the June. So some significant disparities in other districts. That wasn't the case here. So statistically, there was really no difference between June and November. A couple of other, I think, things that we're looking at least as we're evaluating and making advice to districts is what kind of a ballot are we looking at in June? And what kind of a ballot are we looking at in November? Now, there was a lot of talk about maybe getting a legislative statewide bond on the June ballot. The most recent thing I read was that they were to have decided by February 16th. I didn't read anything or see anything that there was an agreement. So we're going under the assumption that there is no statewide bond in June. In fact, the only statewide proposition that we read about in June was this, you know, how to remove a legislator and what kind of punishments a bad legislator would have imposed on he or she should they get crosswise with things. So a non-crowded ballot in June, right? So that means I think voters will have a lot more focus and there's not a lot of things that might bring out a certain type of voter or a certain passion. By contrast, in November, we know already that there are seven propositions that have qualified. And believe it or not, there was over 40 that were still in contention as I was looking at, Ballotpedia that gives you an idea of what's on there. Some of them would include the statewide bond. There's a Prop 227 repeal, which would be related to education. Mm-hmm. There's a hospital payment, a plastic bag ban referendum, public vote on bonds,
40 dishes.
An adult film, STD. Proposition, prescription drug, price initiative, and then, of course, a lot of discussions about marijuana legalization, minimum wage increases, a potential Prop 30 extension of education taxes from years gone by. So we think November is going to be very busy, and that kind of busyness we don't necessarily view as a positive, right? You know, because it tends to bring out more tax measures, more bond measures, and at some point in time, someone might say, hey, you know what, there's four bond measures or taxes on here. Enough is enough type thing.
Yeah.
What else would I share with you on that?
Are there also local, I believe there's a countywide tax is going to be on, or some local issues as well?
We heard it the other day.
Yeah, that I'm unfamiliar with what is qualified or going to be on the ballot, but that was going to be my next comment is in addition to the statewide initiatives, there may be other local initiatives that you might be competing with in some regards. The economy, pretty good right now. Don't know what it'll be in November. Would love to say that it'll still be good, but that's more of a question mark, whereas right now I think we can say, hey, the economy should be pretty good right now.
If I may add sort of the question to yes. Mr. Pace regarding the county, local, from our discussion with, you know, the mayor's office, there are going to be, in November, countywide sort of measures, so.
Yeah, and you know, honestly, I don't necessarily think that having multiple tax measures to the individual voter is a bad thing. I don't think that someone would look at the school bond and say, well, boy, the statewide bond, the school bond, there's a sales tax in the county, the city's doing something. Right. I'm not going to vote for the schools because enough is enough. I worry less about that, I worry more about an individual or groups that stand up and say, hey, enough is enough, and will give everybody reasons why they should start voting no on all of these measures. So it's not what happens in the living room, per se. I think it's what happens in the coffee shops and what might happen with organized or potential opposition. So I would say, yeah, in summary, you know, in evaluating your district, our recommendation would say June for all of those reasons that I cited. Again, statistically from the survey, it's a wash. So then you start look at some of these other qualitative issues around what might be on the ballot, what might not be on the ballot, et cetera, et cetera. So where was the economy be? Where might it not be? So that's, you know, our recommendation as far as this district goes.
Any questions from the board? Okay. Well, this is a resolution. Oh, please.
I'm sorry. A discussion. I noticed it doesn't appear that, like, our district office, which has some facilities issues and some other of the ancillary facilities, they don't seem to be included as potential projects. Am I misreading that?
Yeah, so I checked with Oric, and we could just say, you're right, it doesn't include other facilities as Measure P language had. So we could amend the resolution to say something like, unless otherwise noted, the following projects are authorized to be completed at each of the following, and then list community day school, district corporation yard, transportation yard, district office, GPS, et cetera. And I have that list ready to go if you want to include that and change that. And I have copies of that as well in case you wanted to see it in
writing. Trustee Mickard?
Under limitations on use of bond, it says only for the construction, reconstruction, rehabilitation, or replacement of school facilities. Is the district
Oric thought facilities? That was vague enough, or broad enough, I should say. But the including of other facilities would just make it crystal clear that it was spelled out and called out for.
I mean, this is considered part of our facilities, right?
Right.
Okay.
The project list on page A3. The specific projects are colon, and then it says elementary, middle, high.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I have copies of the old language of Measure P, and I have a few for the public if you'd like to see it, just for information since that was brought up.
I think we should do it. I'd rather be very transparent, as we did with Measure P, and list every district facility.
I agree.
Then we can, as we all know,
Mike.
For the public, we've had major floods in this very room. The entire roof is shot. I think Dan described it as a thin membrane for a roof. So I wouldn't want to leave this or any other district facility off the list. So I think it's better to be transparent and list them.
Trustee Good?
Yeah, I actually have a different opinion. I think we should not include, I understand the needs, but even if the bond passes, we still don't have enough money to take care of the schools. And we have heard from some people a lot over the years, they don't understand that we may have needs of the district office. They don't understand that, you know, the roof comes, you know, leaks and water comes in. What they do understand is the deficiencies in the schools.
Right.
And I would hate to make this bond measure more about, we want to, you know, put gold plating in the superintendent's office, and more about just the school. So for that reason, I would prefer to keep the school sites on and get the maximum support from the community, and take that argument away from people who would not support the bond.
The only counter argument I have to that is we listed it in Measure P, and we had tremendous support for Measure P, even though we listed every facility in the district. So it didn't affect
the voters. Measure P gives us credibility.
Yeah. That would be my counter argument. It doesn't, our priorities are clear. We all saw what our priorities are. But as we've worked through Measure P, as you know, we've had some emergencies come up, and we've had to change our priority list, and this would give us the flexibility to do that. That would be, it's not that the district office is even on that priority list, because we continue to make it a non-priority, even though it leaks like crazy. You know, we've put schools first, as we've demonstrated through the expenditure of millions and millions of dollars now that have all gone to the sites with very little expenditures anywhere else. I know that will continue to be our priority, but by listing them, you have the flexibility, which we probably already have with the language that ORIC has included, but why have an issue down the road, you know, with somebody challenging the language of the bond? I'll go either way.
Yeah. Trustee Russell?
And again, I think we had a very successful Measure P campaign, and we did very good spending, you know, that the community supported. I mean, there's evidence everywhere, and I think there was need for some flexibility because needs come up, and otherwise, money that should come from capital funds will come out of the general fund. Okay. Because, you know, we have needs to fill. And so we know the priorities. We're not even going to get to, you know, all the funding that needs, I mean, all the needs that need to be done, because the dollars are very limited. And you know, it's over time that we get the funds. Even the first Measure P, we still haven't got all the funds yet, you know. There are still some funds that will come forward in future years. So I think it's clear people know we have needs. They know we need to build an elementary school. They know we need to make improvements in these other areas. I think we have a good plan. We have a track record of, you know, documenting exactly what we've done. You know, we have a very good accountability for what we've done. And I think the voters have indicated that they would support this type of measure. And I think we should go forward, again, with the modified language that is in alignment with the Measure P, because I think it's worked. And finally, I support the idea of a June election. I think it's prudent to do that. And that's what I will support.
Trustee McCart?
Well, Mr. Rosso and I were on the board when Measure P passed. And Jaime, remember we did so much background work before it came to a vote. Mm-hmm. I mean, we really did a lot of work out in the schools and had a kind of dog and pony show and a script that we followed, and to try to get the information out to the parents and people in our community. It was a lot of work. My only concern with June is we're talking a really short timeline. And at the sites and trying to get together with parent clubs, et cetera, we're competing with a lot of spring activities, vacation, testing, the end of the year. I'm concerned about this timeline.
Yeah. And if I may add, yeah, I mean, I was in favor of the November way back when, but now hearing more and more, I mean, for me, June looks like a more winnable sort of time frame, but I do have those concerns as well. Again, are we going to put a quality product out for the community to really understand what we're doing and sort of get their support? Trustee Pisano?
I have same concerns about June. I think it makes sense that we go on the June ballot, but we're talking 3 months. And that's, it's we can do it, but can we do it well? And so I'm always a worst-case scenario person. Worst-case scenario, and this is a question, is if we go to June and it doesn't pass, we still have time to put it on for November, yes?
Yeah, that'd be correct. Yeah, the deadline to get it on November would be August 12th. So you'd have some time to evaluate June's results if you wanted to put something back on.
How many times have you seen districts do that, and what's their success rate?
Exactly.
We did that.
We did it.
We did that.
We did it once.
Yeah.
Gilroy's won.
We did it. And won.
You know, to be honest, yes. I think in the cases that a district puts it back on the ballot, they have been quite successful. And I think that's because districts, when they get the result from a June, for example, they know, oh my goodness, we just barely missed it. Let's put it back on. Everyone works that much harder. The people that forgot to vote, all of a sudden they feel guilty and they come out and vote, et cetera, et cetera. But then there are the districts that they lose handily, and they get, you know, 44% or 49% or something, and they say, I'm not putting it back on in November, because that was a pretty loud and clear emphatic no. So I think in the instances where the districts are in the 53, 54%, 75% of the time, those districts are successful putting it back on.
Let me ask this question regarding that sort of, again, the funds that are raised for this campaign is through fundraising, correct?
Correct.
And so we're looking at an average of how much, I mean, just a decimation. If we were to go in June, to my concern is we go in June, if it doesn't pass, we try to go back out in November. Now we're going to go out there and ask for more money. You know, I mean, is the community going to be willing to do that? So,
Again, generally, I would say the answer is yes for those districts that threw it right back on.
Right.
If you were to ask what a, and this is just a real back of the envelope budget. Mm-hmm. I'm just looking at the number of registered voters just to kind of give you a. So there's about 25,000 registered voters. Typically, I'd say a budget of $40,000 to $50,000 would be a campaign budget. We usually say about $2 a voter. The larger districts, it's more like $1.50 a voter. So I'd say about $40,000 to $50,000 would be a budget.
Even with the June sort of being a smaller election, it would still be the same?
Yeah, because you're sending, you know,
costs
you could probably
same.
Get away with a little bit of a lower June budget because, again, reflecting that lower turnout, there are folks that if you've only voted one out of the last eight elections, I'm probably not going to send you a mail piece to say, make sure you vote for us, because we know you only show up for president. So you have a smaller audience to communicate with. On the flip side, you have less pressure to get people out to vote because you can rely on the presidential candidates, the Senate candidates, other initiatives to get people out to vote. So maybe it's a wash. So I'd actually say it's about the same budget.
Okay. Sorry. Question, Russell? Mr. Russell?
Yes. I think when we did the 2008 Measure P campaign, Dr. Flotis was new on our staff. I mean, we had just hired her. And our board was very reluctant to come back with a, you know, because there wasn't enough time to put together, and the, you know, we were unfinished with Christopher High School, and quite frankly, there was seemed to be little support at the board level for these kinds of reasons, and even some of the people that had pushed the prior initiative, again, the first measure the Measure I, it wasn't Measure I at the time, but the first measure, we tried to pass a $59 million project, and the newspaper insisted that we should have a high school too for $59 million, not just only take care of the elementary school needs we had, but we also needed a high school. Right. Well, you know, so we came back and we said, okay, we'll start with the plan of the initial high school, and so we came back and then right, we came right back with the same $59 million and said, okay, we're going to do a start a high school. And of course it passed. And then when we said, well, $59 million isn't going to get us a new high school, we need, you know, we don't have enough money, we came back and they said, oh, it's too soon to come back with another measure. We came back with a $150 million measure, and we won with what percentage of the vote was it?
This was in November.
This was in 2008.
Yeah, I think it was a landslide. 67%.
Yeah, I think it was even higher than that.
67.6.
Okay, so nearly 70% of the vote. So, and we need 55%. I think people see all the development, see all the growth. They know we need an elementary school, and they're not going to turn us down two times. And if they do, then the public is going to pay the price, because they know we need that school. And you know, I mean, we can do our due diligence. It's up to the community to get behind what they know we need. So I think we have plenty of time to get the job done. And if it doesn't pass the first time for whatever reason, we come right back for the second time and we do what we have to do, you know? That's what we do.
You get 5 months second time.
Any other questions? Well, just looking at the public here, they're shaking their head yes, they're gonna support this 100%, so it's... Sorry, please.
I would just add one other component as far as this resolution is concerned. Really, I think there's three key decisions. Well, four if we want to talk about changing some of the projects, or not changing, but adding some clarifying language on the projects. But there's three other questions that would be part of a resolution this evening. One, of course, is what we've been focusing on is time, June or November. The second would be the tax rate. Okay, there's a tax rate statement that is part of that resolution. And then the third would be the total bond amount. Mm. Now, currently, that tax rate statement and the total bond amount is really stretching our limits and is about the maximum that we could do, $60 per $100,000 of assessed value tax rate, which translates to about $170 million bond program, okay? The survey that was conducted when we tested tax tolerances showed a little bit of pushback at the higher levels. I think we tested $60.55, and $49 is what the survey came back as what we would say is affirmative or a strong level of support among voters. Okay, so that's where 55% of those surveyed said, I would do $49 per $100,000 of assessed value. Well, what does that mean? If the district elects a $49 tax rate, you're looking at about $149 million. Okay, so there's a delta there of about $21 million difference between the $170 million that a $60 tax rate can get you and a $49 tax rate and $149 million. The balance in that instance would have to rely upon state dollars. Okay, so $170 million, you do it your own, but you're pushing the limits on the tax tolerance of voters. Or $149 million bond, which is more in line with the tax tolerance of voters, but now we're relying or counting on the state for the balance of $21 million. So I just wanted to make sure that was clear as well, that would be, you know, essentially three questions that need to be answered tonight is date, dollar amount, as far as total bond amount, and tax rate. So I also wanted to bring that up.
Any further questions? Trustee Russell?
Well, again, in the Measure P, we were at 60. Not to exceed 60, and now, I mean, to get us to 170 would be not to exceed 60. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, and so in effect, you're saying that to be safe, or you know, in other
to
words,
maximize
right. Well, to
reflect the voters,
to have a safer margin for success. That you're saying that we won't get the 170 that we really need, but we'll in the interest of having a more likely to have a stronger support, we'll reduce the revenues by 20 million or thereabouts, and so that the tax rate will be reduced to $49 per 100,000, and therefore, so in other words, but we would give up that 20 million. Now, I know in the Measure P that we passed, we still have to spend, you know, we still have
Unissued authorization remaining.
Issued authorization of about
$29 million.
And but we can't access that funds because it would increase the rate. Is that correct?
Correct. You're going to need some good growth as far as your tax base, your assessed value, some continued development. And as the tax base continues to grow, your ability to access those dollars will increase.
So the $150 million that we got authorized in 2008, we still are unable to access 25 or 26, would you say 25?
29. 26 million.
26 million until when? What year?
29 or
29 million in year 2026. Yes.
2026 before we can even access that money.
Right.
So at any rate, and even if we pass this measure, over what term would we be able to access this $150 million if it was $49 million or if it was $170, what term would we be talking about?
Yeah, currently you're looking at about an 8 to 9 year period in these conservative assumptions. So when we say we're going to project 3.5% growth, if you grew it exactly 3.5%, then we would be able to access the final series of bonds in 2025. If we exceed 3.5% growth, then we'd be able to accelerate it or condense that program and get those dollars sooner. The last 3 years, I think the district grew at 5.5%, 6.5%, and about 7.7% growth in the last 3 years, and we also know there's expected continued development. But even having said that, no one saw the Great Recession, no one saw the declines in assessed value, so I still think it's prudent to be conservative, because again, the upside is we get the money sooner than 9 years, we get it in 8 years or 7 years or six or maybe even 5 years. The downside of coming in at 3.5%, there really is none. The tax rate stays what we told voters it would be, and we get our money in the 9 year period that we're expecting it right now.
Right, but again, we're talking about getting less, if we go to the lower tax rate, you know, the safer tax rate, we're really not going to have, we're not going to have the money, we're already not going to have enough even if we went at the 60. So we're already going to be short because we know we need the elementary school, we know we need to rebuild two middle schools. We got Brownell and we got South Valley. I mean, what is it? South Valley was built, what, 1950?
Like 49 or something.
49 or whatever.
56 in Brownell and 49.
And we've talked about things like, you know, gee, you know, those roofs need to be replaced, but it doesn't make any sense because they're all termite infested and blah, blah, blah. And what are you going to do? Spend a whole bunch of money to do a Band-Aid when we really need to replace buildings. So to be prudent, I'm saying we don't have enough money to do those projects. And over time, you know, we're going to need the funds. I'm advocating for us going for the rate of the not to exceed 60, go for the 170 because we have the clear need. It's going to take us 10 years out to gain access to these funds and to be able to get to these projects. So we need an elementary school now. And I think, you know, we have a good track record of how we have spent the money and that we have plenty of evidence and the community feels very good about what we've accomplished. I think to say that we're looking forward, we have a long-term plan. This is not something that the money's going to come out in just 1 year. This is a project that's going to go over. It's a long-term funding project. So anyway.
Trustee Good?
Yeah, so I have a question. So the facilities we want to cover, which aren't included on this resolution, are the District Corporation Yard, the District Transportation Facility, in the district office?
And I think we listed preschools last time, didn't we?
No, because they're covered under the general campus. I would like to add, if we're going to change it to add the new elementary school, and the address will just simply say Gilroy, California.
I agree.
So read the list that you proposed, Alvaro.
So it'd be the one right in front that we passed out. Looks like this. It'd be identical. It has Antonio de Bono, Elliot, El Roble, Glenview, Las Animas, Luigi, Rock Kelly, mm-hmm. Rucker. We would insert a new elementary school in Gilroy, California. Sol Orsano, Brownell, South Valley, Christopher High School, Gilroy High School, Gilroy High School Farm, Mount Madonna, Community Day School, District Corporation Yard, District Transportation Yard, District Office. El Portal, we could change to, just a
GPS.
And GECA is also there.
Was that your question, Mark?
Yeah, so Community Day School doesn't exist, so...
No.
No, that's the old IT building,
yes.
So we can remove that one.
Yes.
Okay, so there it would be Corp District Corp Yard, Transportation Facility, District Office, GPS, and Gilroy Early College Academy, right?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Okay, I'd like to make a motion.
Please.
Because, and it's going to have to be specific, because if we're going to vote on a resolution,
yes.
We have to have the language.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so this would be my motion. I would move to approve this resolution with the following modification. I would add under a separate heading, just like we have the different schools under a separate heading, other district facilities, and then specifically list District Corporation Yard, District Transportation Facility, District Office, Gilroy Prep School, and Gilroy Early College Academy. And then underneath those schools, just like we have, or those facilities, just like we have for all the other facilities, and I'm looking at the list which is included under high school renovation, construction, and upgrade products. I would include the first four bullet items as is. The fifth bullet item, which starts with improve student access, I would delete that paragraph.
Trustee Good, what page are you on? Sorry.
A7.
A7.
Thank you.
I would delete the next bullet, which says replace portable buildings.
Could you just go, nothing? Go ahead.
I would delete the next bullet paragraph, which says update modernized science labs. The next bullet point, which starts off saying improve student safety at drop-off and pickup areas, including, I would delete that language that I just read, and I would change it to read reconfigure, renovate, repair, resurface, improve, and or expand roads, sidewalks, bicycle, scooter, skateboard, storage facilities, and parking and related areas to improve ingress, egress, and safety and increase capacity to meet site usage. Mm-hmm. I would keep the following bullet point, which starts replace or provide heating. Mm-hmm. I would delete the next bullet point, which starts off upgrade, renovate, expand, and modernize classrooms. The next bullet point I would keep, which starts renovate, repair, replace. I would keep the next bullet point, which states provide energy efficient management. The next bullet point I would delete, which says renovate, improve, and upgrade athletic facilities, etc. And that would be my motion.
So, question? What is the intent, Mark, by doing it that way?
Well, you have to say what you're going to do.
Right.
And you have to say what you're going to use. It's the intent is so that we're consistent with everything we're asking for in this resolution.
Uh-huh. So you see some of this as redundant, or what is it? I mean,
you have to say what you're going to do
right.
with the funds.
Right.
And so if you don't say anything, you're not saying what you're going to do with the funds. So your authority to do so is going to be questionable. The only things I'm deleting are things which are not applicable. We don't have, we don't need student access to computers and modern technology in the district office.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Trustee Pace?
I understand what you're saying there. I think GECA is already listed under the high schools.
Correct.
So it shouldn't go here.
Great.
And then maybe GPS could be added to one of the school lists, perhaps elementary school.
Yes.
Or something, so that those deletions don't apply to it.
Right. Yeah, and I would modify my motion to do that so it's more in line with the document. So we would put Gilroy Prep School in under the elementary schools, and we would put GECA under the high schools.
Okay.
But isn't GPS planned to be a K-8 school? So it's not really an elementary school.
So maybe listed under both of those categories?
It's a K-8 school, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, put it under both.
Okay, so Trustee Good's made a motion.
Okay,
please.
Did you write it down somewhere? You made a lot of.
You got that all, Gina.
Changes.
Well, we may have to just listen to the tape.
Yeah, I actually made notations here.
Good.
And I will give it to Gina, which will help in putting it together.
Mark, do you add the new elementary school to a list somewhere?
That's
in your motion.
That's in here already.
Okay.
Yeah, we were going to add that.
But maybe in the gray part, it should also go there.
Yeah, that would make sense.
Okay.
I'd modify my motion to include that and include it in the gray area under elementary schools.
Okay. So we have a motion. Did I second?
We need the motion to include when and the tax rate.
And the tax rate amount.
Yes.
It did include that.
June.
He said adopt this.
Correct. June.
All right.
Yeah. Okay.
And the tax rate?
As is.
Right. 170.
Okay.
Okay, so let's.
Please.
Okay, so I'm just trying to be clarified. So the tax rate is for the 170,
which is up to $60,
right. $60 per 100,000.
Assessed value of 100,000.
All right, and we got the elementary school in there, and you just cleaned up the language. That's all.
Correct. Yep.
Okay, so that's it's so we're basically staying with what is proposed here.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah, I support that.
Okay. Is that a second?
I second
okay.
the motion.
This is a roll call vote. Gina?
Heather Bass?
Yes.
Mark Good?
Yes.
Pat Midgard?
Yes.
James Pace?
Yes.
Linda Paceno?
Yes.
Jaime Rosso?
Yes.
Fred Tovar?
Yes. And passes.
Good. Thank you, Trustee
Thank
Good,
you.
For taking the lead on figuring out how to do
yes.
that.
No problem.
That's great.
Well, we're excited. We look forward to a wonderful campaign this June, and hopefully our voters that are here tonight will help us and we'll get this passed. So thank you guys. Next item 7C, resolution 15/16-49, insurance of 2016-2017 tax and revenue anticipation note, also known as TRAN.
Thank you, Trustee Tovar. And on a totally unrelated matter, this is a temporary borrowing that's routinely done by our district and many others in the state of California simply to smooth out the tax inflows that happen between the collections that our taxpayers pay in December and in April. So the state provides an advanced apportionment for us. That's not a problem. It comes in monthly now that the deferrals are fully funded. But our taxes do come in two big cycles, and we're talking about $41 million. Coming in essentially two payments. So in order to smooth out those fluctuations, we do have to have a temporary borrowing instrument in place, and that's called a TRAN, a temporary anticipation note. And that's really what all this is about, and we're taking advantage of the being in the California School Boards Association pool, CSBA pool, which actually lowers our cost of issuance. We're eligible for up to $50 million to borrow, but we're expecting the figure to come in between $5 million and $7 million, as it was the case last year.
Any questions from the board?
What interest rate do we pay on this money?
It's very low. I think it costs it's $50,000 annually to borrow about $6.8 million.
I would like to borrow money at that rate.
With the cost of issuance and everything included.
I move for approval.
Second.
Second. This is a resolution. Roll call vote.
Heather Bass.
Yes.
Mark Good.
Yes.
Pat Midgard.
Yes.
James Pace.
Yes.
Linda Paceno.
Yes.
Jaime Rosso.
Yes.
Fred Tovar.
Yes.
Thank you.
Passes. Thank you. Next item, 7D, student achievement update. Kermit Schrock, Program Administrator for Student Assessment, will present a brief information report that addresses the most recent California English Language Development Test scores for English learners. Kermit, you know, I'm going to come up with a really good name for you. I have Dan the Man. I have James the Man with the Plan. I'm coming up with something for you next time.
Did I bold that brief in that briefing there? All right, good evening, Dr. Flores, President Tovar, and Board of Education. We up there? We are. All right. This evening, I'm going to be presenting, even without my nickname, the presentation on English language learners, and specifically the most recent CELT data that we have available to us. Quick background, although we've done this quite a number of years already, right? The CELT test is administered every fall annually to all English learners in the district from new kindergarten students. And actually, we start our CELT testing in the summer. We do usually about 2 weeks of testing in the summer to get as many of our kindergarten students done in the summer to try to not interrupt their school day and their first days or weeks of school. Because for the initial students, the students who are new to California or new to schools, they have to be tested within the first 30 days of school with a CELT test, and results have to be mailed home to parents about those CELT tests within the first 30 days. So there's the whole fall CELT cycle has two cycles. There's the initial cycle in those first weeks of school testing every new student, which is mostly kindergartners, but other new students to California or to the district throughout all grades. Then the big annual CELT cycle, which are all of our CELT students, English learners, have to be tested yearly, and that happens through the months of September, October, having to be finished by the last day of October. So now we get in the middle of the year, now the results back. Usually those results come at the end of January, sometime in February, and we had just mailed those home to parents this week with an explanation. The parents get their report, and it comes in the four different categories of reading, writing, listening, and speaking. Which one of the challenges that makes the CELT test to administer is that we do have to have teams of people going around to the schools administering that speaking portion of the test, because each student has to be assessed individually on that portion of the test. And that those tests then help us determine how English language learners are progressing, and for all those initial students as they come into us, if we have students, are they an English learner or are they already coming to us fluent, proficient? So the student gets an initial designation when they first take that test as an initial tester. Some numbers here to look at our kind of numbers, how they've been in the last few years. For a number of years, we were right around that 3,000 mark, 3,200, 3,000 for quite a number of years. But as you remember, last year we actually had a very big reclassification ceremony. And as on a later slide, actually, we reclassified about 600 English learners last year to as reclassified as fluent English proficient. That's about 200 more than we had in previous years. We'd been around 400 in the upper 390s or low 400s for a number of years. So the great thing is that, you know, we reclassified more students, but that also ends up in a reduction of English learners, which is the direction we want to go, right? Our goal is to reclassify as many students as possible, but it's going to also affect the number of English learners in our district. And I also want to just remind, when we talked about reclassification last year was the first year that districts were instructed to come up with their own reclassification criteria, because there was no longer a state test of CSTs that was that other criteria, right? So the reclassification was the CELT scores of a 4 or 5, early advanced or advanced, but some other proof of students performing at near grade level proficiency, right? And so what was that for in the past? It was that 325 CST in English. We said not they didn't have to be proficient, but they had to be near proficiency, right? So we're using our own local measures, our own benchmarks, and other classroom assessments. And we use CAISY, but now that's also not an option for those 11th and 12th graders. So actually that's our next step, is to look at 11th and 12th graders in the future. What other assessments will we look at there for those students? Yes.
I'm sorry, I should have sent this in earlier, but it just came into my little pea brain right now as I'm looking at these numbers. Are the number of initials about the same?
Those have been about the same. There hasn't been a large number. The number of kinder students coming in hasn't varied greatly. I don't have the numbers in the top of my head. I know that we've been in that 300 to 400 range. I have noticed a slight change in the number of initial English learners at the secondary level coming into our ESL classes. I don't know if it's a significant number, but just a few more students have come in this past year or two. Not the numbers that we've had in previous years, in about 10 years in the past, but slight uptick there. So that not enough to be a significant number.
Thank you.
At this point. Yeah, good question. think I got everything on that slide. I just wanted to comment on, since we were talking about the reclassification of those 600 students for last year, as we develop our own criteria, then sometimes it gives us a little leeway to perhaps reclassify students that in the past didn't meet that state criteria. Mm-hmm. Now there's pros and cons on that. Did we over reclassify, right? Are those extra 200 students that we say, you know, did we go a little too low and say these students really shouldn't have been reclassified? Or is this an opportunity to maybe reclassify students who didn't do well on that one state test score in the past, and every year they had to do well on that one test and they missed it by a few points and we weren't allowed to reclassify them? From our fall look at those students, as we looked at how those students did on fall benchmarks, we feel pretty confident that those are students who continue to be successful in class. The schools had to go back and say, if any of those students seem to slip back, they have to monitor them for those 3 years after reclassification. And in the fall look, it didn't seem too out of line there. So from our first look, we're just in the process now of reclassification. Ceremonies are coming up at the end of this month, yes. I guess I'll be having those numbers hopefully in the next week or so. Sites are frantically meeting with filling out paperwork, confirming with teachers, and meeting with parents to look at those numbers. So we'll see how those numbers compare this year to last year.
I did.
All right, jumping into the CELT results. So here's the last 3 years of overall CELT performance. And the four areas, reading, writing, listening, speaking, put together. So we can see we're at the green levels, right? The early, advanced, and advanced. We were at 38% 2 years ago. We moved up to about 42% the previous year. And then this fall, back down a little bit to 38%. A little bit of a drop there. However, having reclassified an extra 200 students, I have to say for myself, I feel very good about the numbers we saw there. I had a real concern that, I mean, those extra 200 students are students who would have just retaken the test and probably been well again, and to have culled off 600 of our top ELs as reclassified and then to still come out pretty much in the same range, I feel very good about with the students who were left there. As you see, the numbers at the bottom, with those students in their early years at the 11% and 15% at the beginning and early intermediate, didn't change much. What we saw is a little bit increased number of students at the intermediate band in the level 3 in the yellow band there, which makes sense. After reclassifying many students, now we're going to have these students there and their next stage up in their years prior to achieving that early advanced or advanced level to be able to be qualified, hopefully, for reclassification soon. And then the four graphs here, looking at each of the four bands, see some general trends that have stayed the same and are reinforced by what we know about language learning, right? Students' listening and speaking scores will often excel ahead of their reading and writing scores. So here we can see that on the bottom two graphs, much higher percent of students in the green bands in the early advanced or advanced in listening and speaking, then taking a few more years, right, for those reading and writing skills to catch up as their overall score then hits that level that helps them hit that level that we can help them be qualified for reclassification. I guess the one thing I was maybe a bit disappointed about, I'm trying to think back, if we look at the writing strand, we know that we've had an increase of focus on writing in our district in these past years, this year and last year, perhaps a little bit, it's been a couple years now, and so I would have hoped to see a little bit of that play out on the CELT writing that we're not seeing there. If we think about the CELT writing versus maybe the performance tasks that we're doing in our classroom, it is a different type of assessment. Our performance tasks are critical thinking and a more of a holistic writing prompts. The CELT writing tends to be a real fine point on spelling and capitalization, punctuation. They kind of get a really fine point there, and do they have the basic English writing sentence structure? Although there is a paragraph right also that's a bit more holistic, the other half of that is on the grammar mechanics, which with our writing really focusing at the performance task level on in-depth writing and critical thinking, maybe that's not playing out for English learners quite as, you know, and paying off on CELT results as per se, but a couple speculations there on that. Questions on those graphs maybe before we move on?
Trustee Russell?
So that would suggest that we may need to rethink what we're doing in this area, because we have invested you know, in our strategies have been deployed, and we're not showing movement here, right?
So I'd say we see the same drop, a little bit of a drop in writing in this year across, in writing just like we do across all four of the graphs, right? So I don't think we're seeing a dip in writing. I would just wondering if we're going to see a bit more of a payoff on cell writing.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Right. This is that we've kind of deployed new strategies.
Right.
For how many years now? A couple years?
Yeah, I'd say second or third.
Okay. And it's not showing, at least not here, it's not showing a result. Mm-hmm. I know it takes a while to get all our strategies in alignment and really having the payoff. But so far, what we've done so far doesn't show that it's creating, that it's being successful.
I'd say the assessment is very, I come back to my previous point that the assessment is very different on CELT. I would hope we're going to see more of a payoff as we look at CASP that does have, a focus on writing at those higher depth of knowledge levels. I would say that, maybe as our writing program moves forward to not only to make sure that there's not a backing off on mechanics and some of the other skills, which then will, that could also be incorporated in ELD instruction. I mean, some of those things could happen in other places as well as our kind of grade level writing program. And I'm just also just speculating here, right? I'm not sure I would say, is it a big concern? I'd also like to see when the CELT test gets replaced in 2 years with the LPAC, which will be its replacement test, will it perhaps more align with Common Core instruction and maybe we see some of the things we're doing in writing pay off a little bit more rather than a test that's fairly old, right, that's kind of going to phase out after one more year. So some other considerations to have, I'd say.
Thank you.
Trustee Pisano?
Well, I think correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems to me we have to keep in mind that 600 kids were reclassified. So who we are testing on CELT are ELs, and the ones that were successful are not being tested. They're no longer being tested. So the fact that we went from 400 to 600, that's a 50% increase. So to say that we're not being successful is not accurate. These are the kids that we have now that are still ELs. So we have to keep in mind we're not testing the same kids over and over, and they're stagnant. This is kind of the snapshot of where ELs are. Am I
correct? And that's why I'd like to say, after reclassifying an extra 200 students, to have our results be almost exactly the same is a success.
You bet.
Yeah.
You bet.
Correct.
You
correct.
Bet. 50%.
Yeah.
That's an additional 50%. I'd say that was
right.
Well,
pretty successful.
I guess part of that is it would be nice to see how those 400 kids, what I mean?
It's true.
How are those kids?
As we've looked at our state data, whether it was CSTs and now with CASP, our reclassified students have historically been very high performing because we've made sure that they're at that level. Now that we're using STRIKE criteria, it'll be very interesting to look at the CASP results this spring as we look at them next fall. Are our reclassified students keeping at that level? Are we seeing any bit of a drop off there? That will also be an indicator. Are we perhaps over reclassifying or not? And that'll be another way we can help measure that. Speaking to CASP as well, I just want to also say, as the CASP assessment is more difficult and as we reclassify students right this spring, we're reclassifying to RFEP all of the students who are near grade level proficiency. That means moving into the CASP this spring, just a month later, we have to also realize that the ELs now, the English learners who take the CASP test, are all the students who a month before we determined are not yet proficient. So we can't have unreal expectations of their performance on CASP because within a month time of this, of that reclassification cycle, those students will all of a sudden not be magically proficient. So when we see very low proficiency rates on CASP, that's exactly right. That means that we reclassified the students who were eligible and the rest are going to need another year or so to hit that level. So if I have to say, if I see a large number of English learners being proficient on CASP, I'd say we didn't do our job in reclassification, right? Because we should have caught that and honored them before that point a month earlier. So just to keep that in mind, because unfortunately, we often get shocked when we look at the CASP results of English learners and say, why are all of our English learners not proficient? Well, it's because we reclassified all those who were anywhere near proficiency. And so it's something for us to keep in mind as we look at that data in the future.
Thank you.
All right. And as everything, things are changing in accountability and the whole cycle of annual measurable achievement objectives, the AMAOs, with the end of No Child Left Behind. This is one more thing that's being left behind as we move forward. And the new cycle is ESSA, right? Every Student Succeeds Act. And we're going to be a year of flexibility next year in which the old accountability systems are no longer in place. I did include charts of our previous AMAOs through 14-15 because we actually did make all three AMAOs, AMAO 1, 2, and 3. This isn't the past year. This is the 14-15 CELT. There won't be a calculation on the 15-16 CELT. So we'll be looking at our data as we are today, look at our 15-16 results, but there won't be an AMAO calculation. But we did make it both AMAO 1 and 2, and in addition, we made AMAO 3. However, I have to caveat that by saying that in this past year, AMAO 3, which is usually on the state tests meeting proficiency, they said was they had to have a participation rate of 95%. So they kind of made a change on AMAO 3 saying, as long as your kids took the CASP, we're going to give you AMAO 3. And we hit our 95% proficiency or participation rate, and we met AMAO 3. So it's great to say we met all three, but it is kind of a...
Under what conditions would someone not take it?
Or? We couldn't track them down and force them into the lab to have them take the test. So basically,
for passing that one.
Exactly. So at the elementary and middle school level, we've always been at the 96-97%, you know, participation rate. High schools are more challenging. Continuation high schools often challenging. So to get an overall secondary rate is often very challenging to get the 95%. But we did hit it. Yeah. But yes, that is a bit of a hollow victory on that one. But in the meantime, it is going away. The Every Student Succeeds Act is working with specifically looking at how we use our LCAP goals to measure. And so that's what's coming out, you know, in this next year will be how to measure the LCAP plan, how to build in this Title III accountability for the federal government for measuring the ongoing growth of English learners at the local or state level. All right, and a couple more charts, because I think I was going to be brief in this presentation, right? All right.
You're doing fine.
All right. This is last year's CELT test, 14-15, because the current 15-16 results aren't on the state site for us to do comparative data with other districts, but just kind of to look, it's good for us to look each year at how are we doing. So, you know, interesting, looking at a number of neighboring districts, GOSD, the number of early advanced and advanced levels 4s and 5s actually above or at the same rate as a number of other unified districts and above the state level. And then that right-hand column, what I just did was looked at how many kindergartners are coming in at the low levels, like so to kind of get a sense of what's their EL population look like. And in many cases, their EL population is coming in a little stronger than ours is, which means they should be able to move them across to proficiency more quickly. Right, if there are not somebody coming in at the 1 and 2 level. What was really strange was that Morgan Hill number from last year at 82%. That was a big jump from the previous year. I think they were at 60-some percent the previous year. So I did not reach out to see if there's a change in their demographics at Kinder, if it was a strange testing situations or whatever, but that was a bit of an anomaly, I thought. Because I included it the previous year in the chart, I thought it was I'll include it for this one, too. We'll watch next year's and see how the data comes out there, if there's a change there, if it was a strange year.
And again, that's 14-15 or 15?
That was 14-15. So 15-16 will get published this summer or sometime later this spring in terms of published on the state site so we could do the comparative data with the other districts. Yeah. Right, so that 42% for Gilroy Unified, they'll drop down to about 38%. Right, that's our 15-16 numbers, 38%. So we'll see if there were... How did that play out across the state? Was there some drops across the state? Was it a uniquely Gilroy drop based on our reclassification? Or was there some test things that happened that make something change across the state? So that's always nice to see that as well. And I think we already talked about reclassification, kind of jumped that up to the beginning of the presentation, so we kind of went through some of those of the numbers that were involved and the elements for reclassification, so.
Any other questions?
That is it for me, unless there's any other questions.
I just question the word near. So you're proficient or you're not, or you're near.
So
what does that mean exactly?
Right, so if you remember, the criteria previously set by the state was they had to be above, at the basic level or above on the CST, 300. They said the minimum score was a 300 on the CST. We decided to go, and Gilroy Unified, we adopted a 325. We said 300 was a little low, then we were confident with reclassifying a student. So Gilroy Unified, we set it at 325, saying you didn't have to show proficiency on the CST, but you had to demonstrate near grade level performance. And so we took that 325. And so we're still keeping that same wording from the state at near grade level performance, saying, you know, if you have a seventh grade student able to read, you know, not necessarily at the seventh grade level, but if they're able to perform well in their seventh grade classes, if they're reading at somewhere in the sixth grade level, they are very near grade level performance, and confident that we can say that student is going to continue to be successful in their grade level classes. And so that's where that near comes from.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Any other questions? Good. Well, thank you.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Schrock. I came up with something. Mr. Schrock, you rock.
There you go.
I know it's a little cheesy, but I am taking suggestions.
Just don't talk to Dr. Sanchez, because he's got his own.
Next item 7E, approval of contract with School Site Solutions for the new school site, California Environmental Equality Act compliance, and California Department of Education site and plan approval services. Mr. Mamachi, please.
Thank you very much, Dr. Flores and President Tovar and esteemed board members. This is the step number two towards making sure that our property is, our new property that we're looking at for the school is qualified. There's three steps that have to be done immediately, what we consider to be due diligence to make sure the property is going to work for us. The first step, of course, we've already taken and begun was the initial preliminary ESA for DTSC, which is the Department of Toxic Control. The next step is going to be whether or not the California Department of Education, CDE, is going to accept the parameters of the property. There's very strict guidelines of where you can put a school and where you cannot. And then the last piece, of course, is going to be the CEQA document, which is the, you just read it, but I'll read it again. It's quite a mouthful, yeah. The California Environment Quality Act compliance. The group that's working with this, I've worked with John Dominguez in the past quite extensively, and he is one of the preemptive groups that take care of these things. I've talked to him. We spent quite a bit of time today going over a plan of what we were looking for and what we're trying to see. Numbers are extremely competitive, and once again, he's probably the best that I know of in the business. Originally came from California Department of Education, so knows all the California Department of Education parameters, exactly which piece goes where and what time. So I'm very looking forward to working with John and his staff to begin the process of heading towards a new school.
Any questions? This is an action item. I'll entertain a motion.
Move approval.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Passes. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Next item, facilities and maintenance operation monthly update. Oh, the dream team. There you go. Yes. Come on, Danny, give a smile. There you go. Dr. Flores had to step out for a second, but she'll be back.
Should we wait?
No, proceed, please.
We can.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. We'll start our normal presentation. You said it's okay to start without Dr.
Please.
Flores? Okay, all right. Same process, same agenda. We'll go through these very quickly, I think. On the revenues and debt service, that first page that we always show you, I wanted to make a correction from last time when I was here. We discovered a typo, and I am such a perfectionist, it really bothered me. So I had to come back and describe to you. We do have $3.8 million in developer fees projected for this current year. Last time I was here, we had thought that we had collected 3.9, and we were suggesting that our projection be 4.3. It was actually 2.9, almost 3 million. I apologize for that, but we do have a projection at 3.8 million for this current year. We all feel pretty confident that we're going to reach that and possibly exceed it. So things that your fees are coming in quite well. But I just needed to make that correction from what I had described last time to you. On the projected expenditures, just a few little things to demonstrate to you. The building queue, because of the timing and the schedule and the bidding process and the bidding dates, I've just taken that and split it up. We think about $211 million this year, and then, of course, it'll go through past July. So,
say that number again.
Yeah, please say that number again.
211 million. I mean, 211,000. I'm sorry. It's been a really long week already. So we just split it up over the two fiscal years because the project will go through the summer and past July 1. I did move the entire Gilroy High School Building G acoustics budget into fiscal year 16-17 because based on information from Jim and the guys that the bidding would occur where the expenditures probably wouldn't hit until the next fiscal year. So we just shifted that one out. Same thing with the Glenview Preschool Portables, which is a new one here. It's coming out of your developer fees, and I think that had been discussed at the subcommittee and probably noted to the board before. That's a new line in here because all of this is supposed to reflect all of your facilities funds, and then we've set it up over the two fiscal years as that moves forward. Again, the Rod Kelly fire alarm, split that up based on the timing of the bids and when we think it's going to hit. And then also the Mount Madonna, there's some things going on out there that we wanted to split up that accurately. And that's it. If there's no questions as far as the cash flows go. Great. Happy birthday, Dr. Flores.
Okay, well, we actually have already been through this. We already did the contract for School Site Solutions, and it has been approved, so I don't think we need to do anything more with that. And we have also already approved the revised change order number one. Where the math, I just want to let you know that sometimes when we deal with these change orders, what begins with a project is, let's say the project is a $100 project to make it simple. And we ask them to add a 5% contingency on that. So now the project is $105 instead of $100 because they added that on there. So sometimes instead of removing that back out to get the 5%, the actual 5%, what the 5% contingency would be, they go with the entire 105. So they take 5% of the entire 105, which clearly throws that number off because now you're more at 7 instead of 5. So that's where the error occurs. People forget whether they had the contingency was in there or not. That only happened once so far, and we'll ensure ourselves to correct that. So that's how those mathematical errors do occur. However, we spotted it, we brought it back, and we asked that you reapprove it so that it's a clean document going in the future. I don't leave anything hanging. I will not leave, you know, because we could just pass it through and say it was already approved. We don't leave those hanging. We will bring those back, mistakes, and of course, throw ourselves on the sword and say, sorry, it won't happen again. So, And I have no intention whatsoever of talking about Elliott gas repairs, so I'm going to turn this over to Dan the Man.
All right.
Good evening. I think you were probably all briefed on the gas repairs at Elliott, but I'd like to just review the whole process just so you understand what happened. We did a roof inspection at Elliott several weeks ago, and my first glance at the rooftop systems, I noticed immediately that there was a defect in the gas pipe. It was severely rusted, and it looked pretty bad. So I consulted our DSA IOR, Jerome Zielinski, sent him the pictures to see if he shared my concerns, and then he also shared my concerns. I got a hold of two contractors to come out to take a look at it. I was hoping this could be a summer project. I knew it was going to be something that needed to be addressed, but I did not think it would have to be addressed this quickly. The second contractor that came out had a high-tech gas sniffer and was getting some readings of seepage, not leakage, not huge amounts, but enough to raise concern. There's a zero tolerance with gas leaks with PG&E right now. I came back with that information that day, talked to Dr. Flores and Alvaro, and they suggested that we have PG&E verify the findings of what we found out with that contractor that day. The next day, PG&E came out, verified the conditions, and worked very hard with us to try to isolate the situation so we could keep the school up, but it was determined the school had to be shut down and repairs made immediately. So we contacted the two contractors that were already involved, supplied us bids. We asked another contractor to give us a bid on very short notice with a 4 p.m. deadline on Friday. We did get two bids turned in. MBS was the least expensive of the two, and they were able to start the next day. They started with phase one, which was all the overhead exposed identifiable pipe. Once we got into it, they were able to identify and isolate the underground systems. There were defective pipes in that system. There were PVC pipe used in the underground, which is not allowed. Natural gas will deteriorate PVC. We determined to eliminate the underground existing entirely and go a new route that was much more efficient to resupply the other buildings without a lot of demolition and excavation. If we would have unearthed all the existing pipe, we would have made a jigsaw puzzle of that site and it would still be in process. So I'm very impressed with what MBS Gas Services did for us. This was done in a matter of 10 days, which was an incredible amount of work to get done. The fact that we had a holiday really facilitated the whole thing. We got it done and the weather somewhat cooperated. And I do want to acknowledge EF&S Concrete again jumped in there and did the demolition and replaced the concrete and asphalt in record time for us. It was a photo finish. If you could have seen that site the Saturday and Sunday before Monday when they came back, you wouldn't believe it could get done. But I was very happy with the results. Good contractors. The other item we have is the GECA cameras. We solicited three bids. We had two return. Total Security Systems was the cheapest of the two that did turn in bids for the, I believe it's eight cameras at GECA. And then I'm bringing back the item for the district office cameras and buzz-in system. Again, Total Security Systems of the three bidders was the cheapest for the camera component. They were a little higher on the PA system, but it was a different system that SAS bid. This was reviewed by Cabinet, and they recommended going with that system. They like that. It's a one-way PA system where there'll be up to six offices notified with a buzzer or a vocal of there's an issue. They can immediately go online and look at in real time the camera in the front office or around the building and identify if there's a situation, if it's something they should come out and respond, call the police. They can see what's going on immediately. So Total Security Systems, again, provided a very good package and used our district standard, what we're trying to use as a district standard of cameras and systems. So I'm sorry I didn't put the prices on there. The Elliott gas repairs, the first phase was $36,925. Second phase was $92,979 for a total of $129,904. dollars. The GECA cameras came in at $14,445.14. The DO cameras and PA system came in at a total of $23,291.96, and these will all be paid out of routine restricted maintenance. I think there's another item on there that's not on my PowerPoint, but it's the approval of purchase of a replacement warehouse truck. I don't know if you've seen the pictures that is attached. That truck is pretty old. It has several mechanical issues, including a lift gate that does not work properly. It has a motor that's worn out, brakes that are in need of replacement, major replacement. So we have tried to come to you with a specific vehicle or purchase, but by the time we go through the process and get to come to this point, the vehicle's usually sold. So I'm asking that we get a not to exceed price for a vehicle, and it will have our district mechanic verify the condition of the vehicle before purchase.
Any questions from the board? Well, we do have several items.
I do have an update also, if you'd like to see that too. Over the last several weeks, we've had several trainings for our crew. One was a sports field seminar put on by a local vendor, Ewing Irrigation, with primary focus on safety of our fields. Our guys, most of our grounds crew attended this. It was a 2.5-hour seminar. I think they benefited greatly from it. We've been rehabbing our fields, and some of the knowledge we got from this helped a lot in the last few weeks. Our entire staff had training by the Red Cross for emergency preparedness, both at home and in the district, and what our role should be and how we should take care of ourselves at home and take care of our families. Another very good training we had by a local vendor, Abbott's, was our chainsaw and gas equipment training for our entire staff. That was a very, very good training. We had a tremendous amount of work done over the President's holiday week. Just to name a few things, the Mount Madonna cameras were completed. The Buzz-In security system part component of that should be completed this weekend. The Elliott gas, of course, got done. Preschool termite work was taken care of. There was some minor damage there. There will be another report to follow, but there was an area of the floor that was damaged severely. We were able to take care of that while the kids were away. Food trailer at GECA has now been relocated to Mount Madonna. All our fire systems, our wet fire systems, there's three components that were inspected, repaired, and taken care of and serviced over the holiday. We had some major repairs that were board approved at Antonio Del Bono, where we had up to 300 sprinkler heads changed out. South Valley Middle School had some very old sprinkler heads changed out. So we are now current at those sites. We now have our tags coming up as our one-year annuals and five-year being posted on all sites. Other items that we got done, the lunch tables at Luigi were replaced, which was becoming a safety hazard. We had to wait a few months for production. We do have those, and Rod Kelly were also replaced. We had some minor renovations taking place over at the Brownell Kitchen. Pool decks at Gilroy High School, I don't know if any of you have been out there, but there's large gaps in the concrete that required caulking. Health Department did not cite us, but recommended we get it done soon. That's been taken care of. So those were all items that we tried to take advantage of the staff and kids not being present, and we're able to get it all done. So that's a picture of a rooftop gas line with a regulator. You can see the rust spots even on the roof membrane. That was black pipe, which is actually an approved pipe to be used on an exterior application, but it has to be coated. It has to be primed and painted with an acceptable coating. This was never treated. So the joints on it, and also this was done with Teflon tape, but Teflon tape's not acceptable for gas pipe. That's some of the trenching that was done. A little bit more of the trenching. So you can see we greatly impacted that site, but it all got put back together. That's an area of the existing pipe that had to be deleted. So we had to excavate right near the meter. That's polyethylene pipe, the yellow pipe. That is a legal pipe. Those are the tables at Luigi. And this is, we're saying goodbye to our last half of the mics. Mike Kaufman retired. We're very sorry to see him go, but we're very happy for him. Huge loss to our department lose both our mics. They were tremendous assets to the district. We will recover. We'll be okay. But they took with them a wealth of knowledge of this entire district.
Can I ask a question about these gas pipes?
Yes.
So, is that something that was done wrong when Elliott School was built?
And there were some parts of it that were.
What is the inspector of records for?
Thank you. That's
yeah,
what I'm
exactly.
Ask.
Well,
isn't that person you. Supposed to check almost everything?
Well,
and the reason I'm asking this is so hopefully, when we build a new elementary school.
I can't answer how that happened in the past, but I can assure you I'm very confident that wouldn't happen with the team you have in place now. But it was quite obvious to me, I've been a general contractor since 1984, that's the first thing I saw when I got up there, that anybody that knows how to thread a piece of pipe knows better than to do what was done up there. Jeez. But I was hoping to be able to do this at a non-emergency status, but I'm very happy the way it did get done and how quickly and how efficiently. We got an outstanding job and product by MBS Gas Services.
Trustee Russell?
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, please.
I just want to mention there's two things that occur on a project. One is the inspector of record. The inspector of record is actually looking for very specific items related to DSA. This would be caught more with our project managers. My project managers would not let this happen because we look at the plans, we look at the specs. In this case, the plans said one thing, the specs said another, but the specs always outweighed the plans. So you have to go by the specs. If you went to court, that's how it works. In the specs, it said that they did not have to paint them. We would have caught that, and we would have made that change. The inspector record doesn't necessarily miss it. However, let me tell you that Jerome Zielinski, our inspector of record, actually caught that in a couple of places at Christopher High School. I was there when he did it. And there was a couple of ends of pipe that the whole thing was painted, and these unions were not. He got them back out there and made them paint it. So in our case, you get two. You get Jerome making sure that this happens. You get your project manager making sure it happens. You get me watching over the shoulder and looking at the plans to make sure it happens. So the answer is this will not happen today. Yesterday, I can't tell you the quality of the project managers. I can't tell you the quality of the inspector of record to actually go out of his way to help out, or the directors or anybody else. But today, this will not happen. So
what if this had not been noticed by Dan?
If it had not been noticed by Dan,
yeah.
Eventually it would have deteriorated, leaked. There would have been a big smell, and then they'd have shut the campus down.
Okay, that's what I thought. But
it would have deteriorated to the point where it was no longer functional.
Thank you so much, Dan, for having such good eagle eyes.
Well, I do want to make it clear that this was never at an explosive state. We weren't close to that. But we did have a severe defect in the infrastructure of the gas piping. So it had to be addressed. And PG&E does have a zero tolerance. They did try to work with us as much as they could, but they had to shut us off. And you can see from the service tag and the red tag that had to be dealt with immediately.
Trustee Russell?
So this is an example of something where there is no recourse, right?
Based on what we told us.
Okay, and when at Luigi, when we looked at that, there was no recourse there either, right?
Antonio Del Bono?
Antonio Del Bono. The
roof. You were getting me worried that something happened to Luigi that I didn't know about. ADB, when we had the problem with the roof, now that you said ADB, there was no recourse, and for different reasons in that case, the contractor and the architect both had passed away.
Uh-huh.
We're no longer in business. In this case, what he's... Our attorney has told us it has to do with the statute of limitations. Correct. So we did get a legal opinion on that.
Okay.
Trustee Pace?
Dan, now that we've gone through this, have you been on the roof of every other school in the district?
I have. I have. Right. I've been on every roof. And I did notice this a few months prior to our reinspection and made note of it. But the second time going up, I noticed it was much more severe than I thought. There might have been another component of cathodic electrolysis going on, too, which has been corrected. That expedites the whole oxidation rust process.
But this isn't happening anywhere else?
No. No.
Trustee Good?
Question about
about the statute, and I reviewed the attorney's memorandum, and it was clear that the 10-year statute on latent defects had been just by, you know, months, but it was passed. So.
Thank you.
I would make a motion to approve 8B through F.
Okay. Do I have a second? Okay. 8B is a resolution. So, okay. So we'd be voting on all of them. Yeah. Yep, okay.
Yes.
Mark Hood?
Yes.
Pat Mithgard?
Yes.
James Pace?
Yes.
Linda Pacino?
Yes.
Jaime Rosso?
Yes.
Fred Tovar?
Yes. Again, thank you all. Thank you all. And if you can, please send Scooter Mike our best and thank him for all the years of services. And also, I think the board is going to direct the two of you to take a couple days off so you can have Saturday and Sunday off. So thank
now
you
now
that
guys. Vacation's over, take a little break.
Thank you. Thank you both. Next item 9, discussion possible action item, request from a Voice for Change advocacy.
This was a request by Christina Hildebrand to have this item on the agenda. We did notify her that it would be on tonight's agenda, and I don't believe she's present. So I have no recommendation for you. This was a request from a member of the public.
Do we have any? We could actually vote on this if we'd like, right?
You could.
Yeah, we could.
I reviewed the materials that were presented, and I'm not inclined to take any action on it personally.
Okay. Good. All right. Next item, board member reports. I'll go first. I have my James Pace moment here, so I want to list some of the things I did.
You got a bow tie?
Took a few days off, and so as Dr. Flores mentioned, we had our monthly meeting with the mayor. Dr. Flores and Trustee McArthur and I met with Perry, and we had an excellent discussion. Just found out that Mr. Gabriel Gonzalez was the new city administrator for Gilroy.
Oh, that's already been approved?
Yes. And he was my number one choice when I was on that panel, so
good.
I'm glad.
Well,
good.
That's right. That's the
yes. And then most of us attended the Green Barn Science event at Gilroy Gardens, myself, Pat Mithgard, Mr. Pace, Ms. Pisano. Anybody else that I missed? No. Okay. And then I had a chance to visit ADB. I also visited Gilroy High, and I also visited DECA this morning with Mr. Rosso, and we had excellent visits, and I want to thank the principals and all the staff for having us there. And as Dr. Flores mentioned, we attended the sports complex dedication. That's it.
What?
Trustee McCord?
So I had the opportunity to visit both Christopher High School and Gilroy High School this week with Superintendent Flores. And personally, I really like this kind of visit. It's not connected to APS. It's just the spring visit. So you're not tied to that instrument. That's the only thing you're looking at. It's more open than that. We had such a good visit at both sites. I mean, I walked away from Christopher. I wrote a note to the principal and said, you know, if there's somebody that is putting down public education, I would like to take that person to both high schools and just have them walk around and see what's really happening. I think there's so much misinformation out there about what's going on in our high schools. There are wonderful things going on in our high school. I mean, I went into classes and I told the teacher, I wish I could be one of your students. I mean, just excellent. The biomedical program is so interesting. You talk about students being engaged. So I can't say enough for just going on a visit like that. I think it's, and also, you know, we have the chance to talk to the teachers. And at Gilroy High, we met a lot of teachers who were outside. Mr. Hungerford, Mr. Jackson, were both outside doing science or math with their students. So that was good to see. So wonderful visits.
Thank you. Anybody else? Ms. Pisano?
Last week, I accompanied Debbie on our Mount Madonna High School visit, and I would like to include Mount Madonna High in that great things are happening comment, and some really engaged kids, and that was on Wednesday, and I went back on Friday for their student achievement breakfast and had a wonderful burrito that morning. In addition to the Christopher High dedication right after that, where it was freezing, Pat and I both, I don't know if any of the rest of you went, also went to the middle school band Spaghetti Feed and had dinner that night, and it was delicious, I have to say. Thank you for them.
I had it for lunch today as well.
And Wednesday I went, or yesterday, seems like 100 years ago, I was at Las Animas and had a delightful time reading to Terry Hinman's first graders. And that was so much fun. And I don't want to wait for another year to do it. I mean, I think I'm going to ask to volunteer in there more often. So.
Anybody else?
One more thing.
Oh, yes, please.
I went to, thank you, Vince Oberst, to a CTA dinner. And that was that was very nicely done. And yes, they did a little, you know, spiel, CTA spiel, but it wasn't too heavy-handed, and I thought it was very well done. And I think those kinds of dinners and interaction with us is all to the good in building understanding and trust. So thank you very much, Vince, for inviting us.
Yes, I mean, as you know, Trustee Bass, Pisano, myself attended that as well, and thank you for that invitation. Trustee
go
Pace?
First,
thank you.
Trustee Bass?
Good evening. I was able to attend the Luigi Aprea Parent Club meeting for the first time. I got to go visit the school, and I pulled up to the parking lot, and I thought there must be a sporting event because there were so many cars, and I realized, no, that was the parent club. And I was very impressed by the attendance, and apparently that's not unusual. So I was very thrilled to be there, and it was great to meet a bunch of new people in the community, very involved and dedicated group of individuals. And they had a lot of different issues going about and concerns, but one that stuck out in my mind and I just wanted to bring to you today, they did mention the need for an emergency exit in their gating. Have you heard that issue recently? So apparently everything's padlocked and they have keys for the padlocks. And so the teachers feel hesitant that they would be able to locate the correct key in the event of an emergency, and that they would love just for everyone to know that in the plan someday for safety, they'd love to have an emergency exit gate. And so that one stuck out in my mind as something that I think I should bring. But it was a great meeting, lots of good conversation. I look forward to many more. And thanks, Vince. That was great.
Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Mr. Pace?
So I'm going to start with some upcoming events to invite you to. This weekend is a weekend of plays. So as Dr. Flores mentioned, Friday at 7 and Saturday at 2, Gilroy High is presenting Once on This Island. Rucker is also doing their play on tonight, Friday and Saturday. And South Valley has a play on Friday and Saturday. So check some or all of those out if you can. Los Animas Gold Ribbon visit is coming up on Monday. Solar Zano band concert on the 8th.
I have a question about that.
Yes.
For the Gold Ribbon, is it, I mean, it's like for hours.
All
or
day.
What?
It's all
and
like
but we're invited
from
lunch,
8 to 1.
Wasn't it?
And I was going to say, we're only expected for lunch, correct?
That's the only time they want us there.
Oh,
that's
okay.
Perfect.
Thanks for that clarification.
I thought lunch, and then I got the whole thing. I thought, they really don't want me there for that whole day.
No. It starts around 8 or 8:30, but Sylvia showed me the schedule, and it's, they have meetings with parents, with grade level teachers, some observations, and then they're ending with lunch, and that's when they invited us to come over.
I think, is it 11:30, 11:45?
I had 11:30.
Is it 11:45? Yeah, which is going
to
be really tight for me.
I like being hijacked.
Continue.
Okay, so Solar Zano band concert on the 8th, ELAC parent university on the 12th, district band concert on the 16th, Health Fair at Gilroy High on the 19th, and March 21st, the Wren Avenue property will be going to the City Council. So that might be valuable to come to.
That's an important time for as many of us as possible to attend, because this is the final step in our Wren Avenue property being approved.
Date again, date and time.
March 21st.
March 21st, which is a Monday.
Probably 6 o'clock.
Your meeting starts at 6, but when we get close to that date, we'll know where it is on the agenda.
Perfect.
And then going back to recent events that I've attended, on the 12th of February, Jaime and I were at the Chamber of Commerce GRC meeting, which is the Government Relations Committee meeting. And it was a good meeting. And the district has been invited to present at the April 8th GRC meeting to showcase what's going on in our district and perhaps talk about the need for a bond and that kind of thing. I was also at the Gilroy Planning Commission meeting, where the Planning Commission unanimously approved the Wren Avenue property, recommended that the Wren Avenue property be approved by City Council. And I must say that the team, the district, and Cal Atlantic worked very well together, very professional. It looked really good. So we have a great team. We picked a good partner. I had fun at the Read Across America event. I got into two classes out at Rucker and got to talk to a bunch of kids, and it was fun. Another thing, the student privacy release, it's been in the news a lot, where a judge said that we have to give all our information. This afternoon, I saw a story that the judge backtracks, won't release 10 million California student records, but will let special ed data go to attorneys.
Yeah, I have an article coming to you on Sunday.
Today?
Yeah, this afternoon.
I have an article already prepared to give you for Sunday that updates you on that. So the judge has significantly modified the plan.
I hope so.
Yeah.
And so much so that as a parent, I'm not going to complete the opt-out now. Because it assures all parents that those records that will be released to the parties in the lawsuit will be very well protected. This is not a general release of information to the public. But I'm sending you some information about that on Sunday.
I'm sure the judge got a deluge.
Oh, they received tons of
I sent
letters.
And that concludes my report.
Wow, James, really? I had this really long list and just busted my bubble.
Would you like to hear some places
No. No. I have one more thing that I want to make sure that I announce. In about 9 hours, Trustee Midgard and myself will be having our first Labor Relations Committee meeting. Vince, we'll see you at 7 a.m. Looking forward to it.
Yeah. 7 a.m. meeting.
Trustee Midgard?
Oh, I just wanted to add about Read Across America. And I wanted to congratulate Principal Polino at Elliott. I mean, she thought of everything.
It was wonderful.
Everything. You know, she's a bigger-than-life personality. But it was just fantastic.
It was great.
The way she had it organized. Yeah. And
with
I wondered.
Students to take you to the classroom.
Yes, I mean, the student
wonderful.
Council kids escorted us to class and gave us a folder and a thank you card. And then I was wondering the source of the book, because we were supposed to read a certain book.
Yes.
And so now I understand. I understand that.
Thanks to Morgan Hill, because they've been doing this for the last three years. They had a committee go through and identify pretty new children's books that were aligned with the standards and what's being taught at each grade level. So we benefited from that. They gave us the list, and we got a discount from a bookstore in Morgan Hill. It's Mr. Horner. I can't remember the name of his bookstore.
Thinker Toys.
He gave a major discount to both districts, so we were able to buy, just as you saw, incredible books.
So this was a beautiful book. Yeah. I took along my own books because in the past, bring something with you, be ready. Yeah. But it was just a beautiful book, and we all learned about mesmerized and
where that term comes
from.
Yeah.
And I was in a classroom of fifth graders, and there were 35 students in the room.
That's amazing. Wow.
I said to this
teacher,
we only have a few of those.
Yeah.
And she's young, and you could tell it was a great class, fantastic things up on the wall. And the kids were right there. I thought, wow, this is a pretty meaty book. There was a lot of information. And am I going to be able to hold them with me? And Benjamin Franklin was in it. And I said, do you know anything about Benjamin Franklin? Oh, yeah, because We read that book and this book, so it was really neat because they were ready for it.
Right, you know? And the scientific method, they're also studying in fifth grade, and that was woven into the book.
Yeah, because you read the same book, right?
It's really well done.
So, boy, a lot of time and effort was put into that school to make that day work.
It's great.
It was really nice.
Trustee,
One more thing.
Please.
Last week in the Khan Academy Learn Storm competition, Gilroy High was number one in the Bay Area for mastery, and South Valley Middle School was number three in the entire Bay Area.
Wow.
We also had six or seven schools in total who are on the top 100 for various categories, so we are doing really well on that.
And the only reason, I have to say on behalf of Christopher High, you know, these internet problems that we've been having have emanated from Christopher High. So they, unfortunately, Khan Academy, the principal was telling us, has been a problem for them because of their internet problems. Mm-hmm. But their whole math department, as well as Gilroy High's, are participating.
Nice. And Christopher was on the list for two categories. So.
Right.
Yeah.
Nice. Great. Thank you all. Next item, upcoming new and referral agenda items. These items will be referred to the executive committee. Are there any? Trustee Good?
Yeah, I have two items.
Please.
First one I'd like to see on a future agenda item is a discussion for possible action on how we might possibly integrate library clerks under the LCAP provisions. Mm-hmm. Look at if we have available funding, if it fits and so forth. The second issue is obvious, but it needs to be put on. We need some sort of a bond committee, right now.
I agree.
Does that have to go through a board meeting in order to organize that?
Is
that
the bond committee, I think, is outside
it's
of
separate.
The board.
It cannot be done at a board meeting.
Right.
Oh.
But I'm just saying
we need to take off our district hat, become a citizen, and form a bond campaign committee.
Yes.
And we need we are going out in June,
right.
Which means we need to do that ASAP.
Yeah. Good items.
Let us know.
We have facilities tomorrow.
I have one item. Would like to see a presentation from DECA. Trustee Ross and I talked to Principal Flores today, and she's dying to come do her SIPSA presentation, but also share all the great things that are going on at her school, the admissions, recruitment, all of that good stuff, and we're hoping that we can have her come out here probably sometime in April.
We just wanted to give her a chance to get back into the job.
And we asked her this morning several times, and she said that she would be comfortable with coming at a board meeting in April.
Sure.
Okay.
Did you tell her student board rep did the job for her already?
Any other items? Okay. Announcements. The next regular meeting for the Board of Education will be held on Thursday, March 17th, 2016. Closed session will begin at 5:30, followed by open session at 7 p.m. The agenda will be available on the district website by 5 p.m. on Friday, March 11th. And time to adjourn this meeting.